Okay, so welcome to the afternoon session. We'll get started here. Feel free to eat lunch throughout. It was a little bit short to go grab lunch. I think a lot of us got caught in the same line made by the rest of the conference. We'll talk this afternoon about some of the more in-depth problems of model selection, cross-validation, kind of some of the stuff we touched on in the morning. I have these hyperparameters for a classifier, like number of neighbors for k-nearest neighbors, number of components for PCA, C, the regularizer for SVM. How do you select those? And more importantly, how do you do it in an intelligent way so that you don't end up cheating yourself? It's a very important point, and I'm going to keep hammering it home. Like, you do not want to cheat yourself because it ends up bad when you go to production. Or when you publish, if you're a scientist. So with that, we start off with a picture of all the data, training and validation again. So I'll zoom this out really quick so we can kind of get a good view of it. So here we see the old thing we talked about in the morning. Take all your data, split it into training and testing, set up your model on the training, and then evaluate on the testing data. Now, if you don't have a lot of data, then maybe keeping a whole chunk aside is not what you want to do. Maybe it's a serious problem to keep 20% of your data unavailable if you only have 100 samples. So one thing we can do is try to do something called cross-validation, and in this case, K-fold cross-validation. So what the K means is we take our data set, and this is for K equal 5, folds. So we take our data set, we split it into 5 equally sized chunks. So like 20%, 20%, 20%, 20%. And what we do is we train on 4 of the folds, or any number of the folds, but typically like all but one. Then we evaluate on the fold that we left out. Then we swap to a new fold that we hold out, train on the others, and evaluate. And we kind of repeat this process. And then we normally look at the statistics over all folds together. So for example, on this split number one, we would train on these, evaluate on this, get some number, our average prediction error. Here we would do the same thing, get a different average prediction error. Here we would get a different average prediction error. Same thing here and here. So what we would end up with is an average prediction error over all folds and either a standard deviation or a range of performance. And that kind of informs us how sensitive we are to different subsets of the data. And this is important because this a little bit ties into being susceptible to a random seed. If you think you're susceptible to having a poor random seed choice by randomizing over all the data, you kind of get a better estimate. There are problems with this, namely when building a single classifier is very expensive, like in the order of weeks or months, then a lot of times you don't have the time or the computational resources to do train 5 different classifiers. But in general, if you want to be robust and you want to really have an understanding of how you're doing, you want to do something like K-fold cross-validation. So here we'll show an example once again with the IRIS data set. Let me zoom back in, where we'll do some K-fold cross-validation. Once again, the labels in IRIS are sorted, so we have to be careful of that. Here we show the right way to shuffle data in NumPy. You have to be very careful about this. If you use permutation on X, you have to use the same permutation on Y. If you use 2 different permutations here, you have jumbled the relationship between data and labels, and nothing good will normally come of it. So typically, you recommend using train test split, unless you have very specific reasons not to. So here's what the code looks like to implement K-fold cross-validation yourself. We have some number K, we have the length of the total number of samples, the fold size is the total number of samples split into even groups of K. Then we need to keep track of the score for every permutation of the folds, and the masks that zero out or remove one fold for testing. So as you can see, this is kind of, it's not a lot of code, but if you can imagine writing this every single time you run an experiment, you'd very quickly become annoyed with writing this code. And it's also a little bit bug prone, right? If you miss this one or something, or you calculate n samples over k wrong, you can have some problems. So it's not hard code, but it is tricky and it is prone to error. So for now, let's just look at what the masks are doing. And we kind of see, if I zoom out here, that it's doing what we expect. It's holding out one fold, training on the rest. Holding out one fold, training on the rest. And so we can see that if we have different folds, we actually score perfectly. Other times, we do fairly poorly. This 0.90 and this 0.93. And on average, we get 0.96. But if you look at the range of our error, we go everywhere from 0.9 to 1.0. So it's 0.96 with like minus 0.5 and plus 0.5 on either side, capped at 1. So this 0.96 could be deceptive, basically. It's the only point I'm trying to get across. The statistics of how you do over different folds can be important for analyzing your classifier. Yes, this is right. Because these are only, yeah, there's a lot of issues in choosing the right split. And if you do more classic statistics, there's all kinds of different methodologies. Leave one out, leave P out, bootstrapping. It's a whole bunch of different ways of approaching this problem. We only do a few of them in scikit-learn. But depending on your problem, you might find it's important. So because this is so common, we implement the cross-val score for you. So given an X, given a Y, and a classifier, it will do this kind of splitting into permutations and calculating scores for you. By default, three folds. You can change this arbitrarily. So you can go up to five folds and see that sometimes it scores well, sometimes it doesn't. You could change this to 10. You get 10 answers. 20 answers. At some point, you get to where you're leaving only one sample out, and maybe that's useful for your problem, maybe it's not. It really depends. Most of the time, in the limit of large data, a couple folds is enough to make you more invariant to which fold you choose. So we have a whole bunch of different ways to do cross-validation. So in this case, the labels are basically equal weight. There's like 30% 0, 30% 1, 30% 2. But that's not always the case. Sometimes the number of labels we have per class is distorted. So in that case, you might want something like a stratified k-fold. What that means is we take an equal percentage of each label rather than an equal number of each label. So if there's only 10 zeros and 100 ones, you might want every fold to preserve that relationship. Or not. Once again, it really depends on your problem and the task you're trying to solve. Most of the time, you want things to be stratified. So stratified k-fold shuffles for you, so that's helpful. It doesn't shuffle. This is what this, that's what this is saying, right?
Yeah.
Because it's always taking a proportion. So you're guaranteed not to slice out a whole chunk. Yeah, and so you can see this stratified k-fold actually returns an iterator for each stratified subset. So the same with k-fold, same with shuffle split. I'm not sure what else is being imported here. Leave p label out. There's also a leave, I think there's still a leave one label out, which is really like leave p out with p equal one. So there's a whole bunch of these different iterators that will generate these indices for you. And so they're really helpful for making sure that your training and testing data don't have overlap. So we can plot the masks again here. And we can see that we're preserving the clash ratios over the split. So we're taking like a little chunk here, a little chunk here, and a little chunk here, because the layout of the labels was originally zeros, ones, and twos. So we want to take pieces of all three for every iterator. This does not do that. So yeah, another important point is more cross-validation is typically better, but it means you have to train more classifiers. If you have a big cluster or something, this might not be a problem. Just run some large number of jobs, train 20 classifiers in parallel, then average them at the end. If you only have one computer or it takes a long time to train, then the difference between training one classifier versus 5 versus 20 could be the difference between iterating on ideas and publishing and never finishing your experiments. So there's a trade-off here between how many iterations you run and how much time you're willing to spend.
Are you saying that more bulk is better?
Generally, it's recommended because you can get better statistics about what's happening. However, in the limit of, like, we take the cross-validation all the way out and we pull out only one sample and train on everything else, that might not actually be useful because a single sample could be biased statistically. So there's kind of a trade-off between how big a chunks can I pull out and still run my experiment. So typically my methodology is I want the testing set to be as big as possible because I want to train on as little data as I can and still generalize well. But if you have a really complicated model, it needs more data to train effectively. So there's kind of a back and forth there. And if you read some, there's some arguments back and forth in like the statistics community about leaving one label out, being biased to certain types of error, and there's like statistical concerns with going really small. So we won't talk about that too much, but just know it exists. And typically 5 or 10 folds is common. And that's enough to kind of say, I ran 10 different things and I got these numbers. So it's reasonable to say I averaged this over 10 different numbers, and this at least gives people who read your paper an idea that it's not just blind luck that you're doing well. If there's something fundamental that's performing. So shuffle split can actually repeat portions of the data instead of making sure that they're left out. This can be useful. I don't tend to use it. I don't really know why. I tend to use K-fold or stratified K-fold more. But once again, these are all kind of different standard methodologies for splitting up your data and training. And apparently I can't scroll back now. That's helpful. So with shuffle split, because you can iterate more, you can increase the number of iterations, and you get more random samples that you trained on, and you're guaranteed at least that the training and the testing data have no overlap. However, between iterations, between models, there is some overlap in the data they see and the data they don't see. So this is kind of a different way to approach it. And here you also have no guarantees that you're grabbing some portion of every label. Maybe that's okay, maybe not. Once again, you can use all of these iterators with the cross-val score method. You just create the iterator and pass it in as an argument to cross-val score. Question?
So when you're doing this cross-validation, if you do, say, 20 iterations and you want to move something to production, which actual classification would you take?
So there are a variety of ways to do this. One way is to take each classifier and run them all. So take each classifier, run a different split, get all of them to predict, and then either take the average of their prediction or take the maximum, like if there are 5 of these predict 0 and 2 of these predict 1, that means something. And that's like ensembling or bagging. And we'll get into that a little more later, but there's a variety of ways. Alternatively, you can, if you don't want to spend the compute to run 10 models at the same time, you can also choose randomly one of them every time someone asks. And that's not great, but it means that asymptotically you should get the performance you expect. And once again, there's a whole bunch of methods, and Andy's about to say something.
Retrain on the whole data set, right?
Retrain on the whole data set. before you go to production. That works too. So the question was about PCA and PLS selecting the optimum number of components. So the concerns about that are related to the concerns you have when you do cross-validation. That's mostly like hyperparameters and model selection, which is the very next notebook. So it's related to this idea, and you use these same iterators and these same techniques, but in a little different way. Yeah, so the comment was on using grid search to find the best estimator and then retraining on the entire data set and using that in production. So yes, you can absolutely do that. And normally that's how we use it. We use it to select hyperparameters, and we use it to figure out if we're robust to different splits of the data. And if you want to use an ensemble method, this is also the way you do that. So there's kind of some trade-off there. But you can use it absolutely to do model selection and say, like, if you do cross-validation over k-nearest neighbors, over SVM, and over logistic regression, and you see that over k-nearest neighbors for different splits, there's a huge variance. And for logistic regression, there's a small variance. You might actually say, well, I want the thing that has small variance because I believe testing data is going to look like a new fold. And that's normally what you want. Okay, so now we're on to model complexity and grid search CV. So once again, we'll import matplotlib and numpy. So this is where we get into parameter selection. And I call them hyperparameters, but some people will say parameters. What it boils down to is when we create the object, we have some thing that we have to set. Number of neighbors, number of components, C or nu or gamma or some parameter for the mathematical piece of the model. And so there's some real subtleties in setting that. So one very kind of obvious way that you would approach this is you would just say, oh, well, I'll train on something, look at the testing score, and then set my number of neighbors to the thing that gives me the best testing score. That's a bad idea, because what ends up happening is you are overfitting on the test set with a human in the loop. If you look at the scores on your testing data when you're setting these parameters, like k for k-nearest neighbors, then you're looking at the score on the test data, and then that information is feeding back into the model that you choose. So there's some real subtleties that come into doing this parameter selection. And most of the time, and we'll cover this in just a second, you end up wanting a training of validation and testing for this kind of stuff. And so you can do this by doing cross-validation and making sure that the hyperparameters you choose over all the splits of the data are pretty good, or in the case of like other models that scikit-learn doesn't focus on as much, you just hold out a chunk of data and that's what you do. So hyperparameter selection or parameter selection in this notebook is really important, and you have to be careful that you're doing it correctly. So for this example, we'll plot some k-nearest neighbors. So here we have a sine wave. If I set nearest neighbors to 2, we predict some kind of really crazy square sine wave. It probably sound cool out of your speakers, but doesn't necessarily match up with our idea of a sine wave. If we turn up nearest neighbors, we start averaging things more, we start getting a smoother estimate of the data that we're trying to regress on. As we turn up nearest neighbors even more, we start to regularize to the point that we're just kind of predicting the trend, which could be useful or could not be useful, depending on if you think these little upswings and downswings in the sine wave are important to you or not. So it's obvious that the number of neighbors you choose has a huge effect on how you perform. And typically there's two basic modes that a model can be in. Well, three, but it really never truly happens in practice. There's underfitting and overfitting. And so what does that mean? Underfitting typically means something like the model over here on the right, where we have something that's, it's a good estimate of the data, but it's kind of pessimistic. It's kind of saying, well, this data really looks sinusoidal, but I prefer answers that are pessimistic on these small trends in the data. I want like large global trends, so things are very regularized and very smooth typically. So in SVMs, there's a parameter called C, which controls this. For logistic regression, there's also a regularization parameter. Most models have an extra term that controls kind of the regularization of the model. And so that's one way to figure out if I'm underfitting over here and it's too regularized, I can turn down C and I should be able to go more over here. Or for nearest neighbors, we think adding more neighbors is kind of a way of regularizing the model. So if we reduce the number of neighbors, we should get more and more and more into where we're predicting more interesting variance in the data. However, we can go too far, right? If we have training data that looks like this, and then the next test data is just a flat vertical line, then it's actually a bad idea to pick up all these subtle sine wave trends that may or may not be really present. So you normally control this with regularization, and that's one hyperparameter you use for your model. And this plot kind of shows it. In the ideal world, you would have a fit model where every parameter is tuned perfectly and everything is just working just right. Like you're not too hot, not too cold, if you're familiar with Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Unfortunately, in the real world, you almost never get this perfect, and that's okay. So the best you can do is try to minimize the amount of overfitting or underfitting you're doing. And we'll go into some detail about how this is done. And things are, all right, there we go. Ah, so here we go. Sweet spot, that's what we want. Oh man. Yeah, okay. So we trade off remembering that training data is training data. And if we sit and we train our model too long on training data or set things too particularly just for training data, it doesn't represent the new data we're going to get. And at that point, we have overfit the training model and we're not going to do well. We're not going to generalize when new test data comes in. So splitting into training and testing is one kind of simple way to make sure that we don't overfit. But as soon as we start tuning these parameters and we're looking at the test data, then we've kind of folded the testing data back into the overall set of data we look at when we make the model. Because setting the parameters of a model is part of building a model. So that's when you get into having a validation set, like training, testing, and validation, where you might look at parameter settings like number of neighbors or C on a validation set. So you train on the training set, look at the score on a validation set to set C or N neighbors or whatever, and then the test set is where you actually evaluate and just say, this is the score I got. I'm not even going to change anything based on that. I can only really look at training and validation. And so you can also do this with the cross-validation tools we saw. You could have like validation splits and training splits and testing splits, or if you're bold, and I'm not, you could also set your hyperparameters based on the cross-validation average and kind of say, well, this works over all five different cross-validation iterators, so it should be fine. It really depends on how you want to approach things. So in general, we have underfitting where we're not really capturing the true trend of the data well, and overfitting where we're doing way, 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 way too much to it. I want to find the sweet spot. And so in this case, the graph is up with the assumption that we want to maximize the score. Sometimes with things like regression, that we'll see in a little while, you might also see the inverse of this graph, where things are going down, 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 and then at some point training goes to zero, and then this curve, which is test or validation score, kind of goes down, 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 and then kind of scoops back up. And so what we want to do is minimize the gap between the training and validation score. And so however you can do that is a good way to set things. So now I'll zoom back in and we'll run some more examples. I think we use a lot of sine waves here. And there's no general rule to find a sweet spot, by the way. For some models, you may actually want to be pessimistic. So for things like medical studies on fMRI, they are very, very, very selective on the models they use. They typically like linear models that are interpretable and accessible and make pessimistic estimates of predictions, because for the data they have, it's very easy to overfit, and it's very easy to say, I understand the brain, and no, you only understand like one person's brain a little bit or something. Whereas on the other hand, if you do kind of neural network type research like I do, we really, really, really just kind of go all out. We use the most complicated model possible, and everything is basically in reining that in. And so random forests kind of have a flavor to this as well. They're very good at modeling data, and you kind of have to rein them in from overfitting. So depending on the model, they have different tendencies, but every model that I know of, at least, has a way to kind of trade these things off against each other. So we run k-fold on the nearest neighbor's regressor, and we look at the number of neighbors and the average score. And so we can see that for different settings of the data, we get different average scores. And I believe this is using so this is just the mean of the score, and I think it's using the R2 score by default. So as we up the number of neighbors, we kind of see that there's a point where the score goes up, which is good, and then at some point it goes down again. So that's kind of our little curve of how well you're doing. Okay, now you're falling off in performance. You want to fix that. And so if you plot the validation curve for the k-neighbors regressor, you can see that for various settings of k-neighbors, you get different scores. And it looks like, even though this particular plot is kind of up and down, it looks like this right here, n neighbors equal 10, might be the sweet spot for this particular model. So many neighbors means a smooth or simple model, which means it's highly regularized. So in generally, when we talk about regularization, Andy in the morning showed that nice plot of K neighbors where the decision boundary was really crazy. So as you turn up the number of neighbors, the decision boundary gets more smooth. And normally that's what you will see when you turn up regularization. So the negative numbers on the side here are... That's a good question. This could be law. No, it must be the R squared is going negative. Whatever metric we're using here has a negative score the farther we go over here. So it really depends on your metric. Like if you have a mean squared error, you're not going to get zero. But if you take the log, then it might be negative. So this is mostly a function of what your metric is and what scale you represent it in. So that's also important. Depending on the scale of your metric, it can make it easier or harder to see these trends. Just something to keep in mind. So I'm pretty sure here this is the R squared score by default. So now we'll look at the same thing with support vector regression, which has two parameters. We'll kind of loop over both parameters and try to select the one that does the best. And this is great, and this is called grid search. So this is the simplest way to choose parameters, is I have some set of parameters, I make a grid in parameter space over both of them, and I test every single point, and then take the best one. This is great, but it's also expensive. Depending on the size of your data set, size of your model, running this many as support vector regressions might just be completely prohibitive or impossible. So there's different kind of patterns for how you do this kind of multidimensional search. So grid search CV is the classic one, and it's built into a whole bunch of models and is generally the simplest method and should work well. So you set some parameter range for each parameter, where this is a dictionary, and this key maps to something that SVR takes as an argument in the constructor, and then build the grid. And in this case, we want to see what it's actually doing. And then we fit it. So this grid thing is kind of like a model that runs many models internally. And here we can see all the different stuff that it says while it's training. It's saying, I'm training a model with gamma 0.001, C equals 0.1, and I get some score. And this isn't formatted super well, so the scores and the parameters aren't quite on the same line. And then when you're done, you can use predict, and it will use the best the model with the best score to do your prediction. No. The parameters are the best trained on all the data. Yeah. So it does the extra step for you of looking at the score, saying this is the best score, train on all the data, retrain on all the data, and then predict. So if you have grid search and the grid has 100 points, you're really fitting 101 estimators, because there's that one last pass of best parameters, all data. So you can look at the best score, the best parameters, and then this would be the parameters you would use if you did it on your own. You would set up a new SVR with these two parameters, train on all the data. But there's a problem that I alluded to earlier. If you do this to select all of your possible parameters, you're testing a whole bunch of different things at once. So if you try a whole bunch of parameter settings, one will work by might work better or worse by chance, and then you might not generalize as well on test data with those parameters as you want. So then you get into the pattern that I mentioned earlier, training, validation, test, split. So what you do is you take all your data, split it into training and test data, and then take that training data and then take a small subset out of that, either with cross-validation or just withholding another subset. Then you train on this, set your parameters either on the average of the cross-validation or on the score on validation set separately. Then your final evaluation that you might report in a paper or report to your boss or whatever is taking that classifier, trained on all of the training data, validation included, and predicting on the test data. And then ideally, you don't change anything after that because you've now looked at the test data. So any decision you make is poisoned by the fact that you know the test score. In practice, that rarely happens, but that's kind of the idealized concept of what you want. So let's look at that. Yeah, so the comment was on splitting everything up into another loop, and that's what we're about to show.
Can you make it one larger?
I went too larger, maybe too much. Okay, so now we can take the grid search object, fit it, look at the score. And so the easier scheme is the scheme that I'm talking about. Three parts, training, validation, and testing. This is a good alternative if your training set is very large, like you can withhold a training set, or you can withhold a test set and a validation set, and you still have a million samples. What is another 100,000 samples that you hold out? It doesn't really matter. If you only have 50 samples, you start to care about holding out 5 or 10 for validation. So now we show an example of doing a train test split, running grid search CV on the training set only, and then scoring the test set. So this kind of implicitly does a grid search on the training data only, finds the parameters, and then you test the generalization. And then ideally you don't run this again, but once again, that rarely happens. You thought there was another example of cross-validation, like? I don't know what you're talking about. So now Andy is going to add stuff on the fly.
Sorry, I thought it was in there. Apparently I missed it. So to address your question, the question was, well, now we have this one outer split, which might not be very robust, and we can do cross-validation over the grid search parameter faults, which is a bit crazy but very robust. So if you can, if you have not that much data or you have a lot of time, you can do something like this. So the grid search CV looks just like a classifier. So you can your classifier is this grid search CV object. Let me see what we had before. I hope this is not too large, but okay. And then we do cross-val score on x and y. So, oh, that was quick. Okay, it's iris, right? No, it's some synthetic data set. Okay. So what this does is it does the cross-validation split. So split it up into three parts, as cross-val score does, then does grid search on two tests, which does, again, a cross-validation, and finds the best parameters. And then it does, then the outer loop goes on the other two scores. Okay, it's a bit hard to explain that. So this does nested cross-validation. So there's an outer loop going over three folds, an inner loop going over three folds. The inner loop selects the parameters, and the outer loop evaluates. So that basically does this scheme twice. So, okay, that was answering this question.
So as you can see, there's a number of ways to handle grid search. There's also other methods. Well, there's one other method like this currently. There's random search CV that uses a different kind of scheme to lay out the parameters in space and then choose them. So even in cross-validation, there is active research trying to figure out the best way to choose hyperparameters. And you get into a thing where you have a model that learns the hyperparameters for the model that learns the parameters to predict. And there's kind of like this meta research happening. And so there's a lot of different work there. And there's some stuff that is in progress to getting into scikit-learn as well. So for now, you can go train, validation, test, cross-validation and test, cross-validation, and then a separate validation and test, and any kind of permutation of these, depending on the requirements of your problem and how much data you have. So 4.3 is the last section I'll be discussing, and it's about analyzing model capacity. So different models have different capacity for the types of functions they can represent. So we've even seen it in a simple fashion with k-means, and or k-nearest neighbors and logistic regression. So they had very different decision boundaries, and it was obvious that k-neighbors with one or two can learn some pretty crazy intricacies of the data, which you may or may not want, whereas logistic regression fundamentally is drawing a line. So that's naturally kind of like a very smooth decision boundary. Even without regularization, it's kind of like a pessimistic, smoother estimate. So between models and between methods, there are different capacities for learning. And more importantly, for each estimator, how do we analyze our capacity and figure out what things to change to perform better? So there's a number of things we can try to do. We can try to switch estimators. Scikit-learn makes this very easy. Switch the import, instantiate a new object, set some parameters, and then train. We can actually look at the data. We can either try to remove features that we think are uninformative or confusing, or add new features that we think are smart. Maybe like sepal width and sepal length are no good, but maybe like the height from the ground to the top of the flower means something. So then you measure that, put that feature in, and then train on that. You can also add more training samples, right? Maybe you just go do the same measurements, but go measure a bunch more flowers. So this is kind of where you get into the cost of data. So it can be cheap depending on what you're trying to do, if you need experts or just general labels. But either way, here you're trying to fundamentally get something new that you didn't have before. Whereas this, hopefully, in scikit-learn is just swapping new estimators. And this is one of the real powers of the scikit-learn API. It lets us efficiently and simply swap between different estimators and try to figure out which one's best for a problem. So sometimes using a more complicated model is worse. Sometimes adding training data will not help you. We'll kind of talk about the two different regimes. Fundamentally, these two kind of trade-offs boil down to underfitting and overfitting regimes and making sure you know which one you're in so you know the direction to push your model building. So for this, we build something called learning curves. We kind of saw a version of this in the last notebook. There's a scikit-learn example that I linked to here that shows it for logistic regression and polynomial features. Here we're trying to use support vector regression again. It takes a hyperparameter called kernel. Andy will talk more about what kernels are with respect to SVMs and SVR later. But basically, you can think of it as a hyperparameter where there's an ordering of the linear kernel is simpler, polynomial kernel is a little more complex, and the RBF kernel is a little more complex than that. So let's build some function, plot it, and look at it. So in this case, it's basically just x cubed with a little bit of noise on top, where this random seed is not set. That's my fault. So it might look a little bit different for you, but it shouldn't make a big difference because the noise is pretty small. So here we look at SVR with each of the different kernels and a fixed setting for C, and we evaluate them using cross-validation and look at how the best model predicts, like the kind of the curve that the best model would predict. So in the case of the linear kernel, the best it can do is really kind of draw a line that minimizes the error here and here and gets these points pretty close to right, but that's about the best it can do. Here, if we use a polynomial kernel, it's a little more complicated, but it can actually model x cubed effectively, and you get a really good score for mean squared error. And then for the RBF kernel, it's a little bit overfit in that it kind of sees the data and some of it got held out in here and in here, and it kind of overestimates the bump here and the bump here. This is really mild overfitting, but it's a good enough example for what we want to talk about. So here, this is probably the parameter settings we want. This is probably too simple. This is probably too complicated for this particular set of data. So let's look at the learning curves. Well, first we look at the learning curves and why more data can help us build a complex model. So once again, we have the same data with a little bit different noise, but basically the same core function. So if we only have very, very, very few samples, and we can't see this curvature here, we wouldn't really know what to do. In the limit of very small data, typically you want to be pretty pessimistic in your estimate. Like the best you could really say is draw some line in here, probably. As you add data, okay, there's something going on here. Maybe this is just lucky grouping. Maybe this is noise. Maybe we still draw a line, or maybe we kind of make a little curvy line here. And once we start adding more and more and more data, we start filling in the points along the function, and we can get a better idea of how we should model it. And in two dimensions, it's obviously pretty easy to do this. And as you get to higher and higher and higher dimensions, you end up needing more and more and more data to compensate for this. And it's something called the curse of dimensionality. I won't talk about it too much, but we've kind of alluded to it throughout the talk. Like, intuition and the things you do in low dimensions tend to break down in high dimensions. And this is one of the reasons more data is usually better. And at least for me, more data, yes. So all of these particular plots here come from the same underlying process, right? We just have some subset of the dots that we plot here, plot more of them, plot more of them. But if you ask to make a prediction, you only likely to draw a straight line for this one, curvy line, maybe a more curvy line here. So this is kind of describing what I talked about before. So this means that depending on your data set size, if you go out into the world and collect more data, that could fundamentally change which model performs the best and which one you want to deploy. If you really think that this describes your true data, you want a more complicated model. If you think that this line will basically fill in kind of as a noisy line to regress on, then maybe you want a more pessimistic estimate. So as the number of training samples increases, what do we typically expect to see with training error and validation error? So normally what you see is the more training samples you have, the higher your training error will be. You can imagine in the limit of an infinitely sized training set, how do you generalize from infinite? Well, you can't, right? You've seen all the data that could ever exist. Therefore, whatever you predict for the training set is whatever your model will perform as. The real world, we never have infinite data, never. Even really, 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 really big data sets are pretty small compared to the all possibilities. And if you have a data set where you can really enumerate every possibility for the future, you're kind of done. Congratulations. So for validation error, what do we expect? As we grow the validation set size larger and larger and larger and larger, especially if you hold the training size fixed, we're seeing more and more and more and more and more data for the validation set. If we don't generalize well, we expect as the validation error gets bigger, it's approaching the limit of infinite data. So if you could predict that well, you would generalize perfectly. So as the validation set size grows, you typically tend to see like more and more and more validation error unless you're generalizing well. So typically what we end up seeing is lower training error than validation error, because ultimately training error is the stuff that we've looked at. We've looked at this, we've trained on this, we should be better at this than new data typically. So in the times that this changes, it's normally one of two options. You're either underfitting to the point that your predictions for the training error are super pessimistic, and your predictions for the validation error are super pessimistic, and because of random numbers and random selection, you might have some flipping back and forth, but they're pretty close to the same. Like one might be barely lower than the other, and it might swap on a different fold of cross-validation. The other alternative is if the validation set is somehow easier than the training set. For whatever reason, the particular statistics of the training set are hard to predict and the validation set is a little easier to predict. And this is one of the reasons we use cross-validation, is to kind of avoid this problem of like, I chose a really hard validation set and so I'm having a hard time generalizing. Maybe that's even harder than the test data you expect to see from your real system. So now we can plot the learning curve for the linear model and visualize kind of what I'm talking about. So here, this is mean squared error, so lower is better. Some of the other plots use a higher is better convention, really depends on what you're used to. Do you like to maximize a function or minimize a function? So here, we saw the plots earlier, we believe we're underfitting. So what we see is we're better at training than testing, but it's basically flat. As we add more and more and more and more data going to the right here, we don't really see any benefit. We don't really see any kind of curve. Both stay the same distance apart, and they're both. The comment was on, I talked about training and validation, and as the training set gets really, really, really large, that means something for the errors that you would see both on training and validation. And the point was raised that that assumes you're sampling from the same underlying distribution. So one of the really, really, really big issues in machine learning that is hard to deal with in general is you assume that validation and testing data and training all come from the same kind of generative process. And there are methods to try to figure that out if you think that the distribution of your data is drifting over time. You deal with this a lot in like e-commerce because there's seasonality in the way people buy things and the way they consume ads, and you have to account for that. And so saying, okay, I'm going to hold out this chunk of my data set for validation. If it's a Monday, you might get a completely different answer than if you hold out Tuesday and Wednesday and so forth. So for some domains, like especially like e-commerce, medical, a few others, you have this problem of covariate shift where the data set, the distribution of the validation data and the test data, if it's split from the training set, might still be different than what true test data comes to you in the field. So the comments I made before are specifically to the case where the data you're looking at for training and validation are both kind of, it's not the same samples, but they kind of have the same properties, the same behaviors. Like if you're looking at cats and dogs, it doesn't switch to looking at mice or something. Like that's a fundamental shift in the data you're analyzing. So I guess here we'll kind of go back to what I was talking about with the learning curve. So as we add more data, we see that there's not much change in the training and testing scores. So we're not getting a lot of benefit from adding more and more and more and more and more data. What this probably means is our model is too simple because we're not able, it's already doing the best prediction it can given its capacity. So adding more data isn't helping at all. That's very typical of underfitting, and normally this is accompanied by a pretty high error. What high means is pretty relative depending on your problem. Like for some problems, a high mean squared error might be in the hundreds. For other problems, it might be in the like ones or 0.1s or 0.01s. Normally, the way you can counteract this is if you see you're adding more data to the model and nothing is happening. Your training score is not getting better. Your validation score is not getting better and then getting worse. Normally, you want to turn up the complexity of the model. In the case of support vector regression, this is like making the kernel different. In the case of k-nearest neighbors, it's like turning down the number of neighbors. For logistic regression, this is changing the regularization parameter. Most models have a way to, like kind of a sliding scale, to move between these. And actually for this particular model, you could change not only the kernel, but also the C parameter, wherever it was. It was only five. So this is another thing that you can use to control the complexity. Here I kind of cheated because I know the true, it's a toy problem, so I know the true thing should be polynomial. So in general, you'd want to search over both the kernel and C, and then you get back to kind of grid searching like Andy talked about in the previous section. So we can also look at what happens when you're overfitting. Well, so first let's finish underfitting. So you can use a more sophisticated model. Alternatively, you can add more features for each sample. This might be something like, okay, the model is in three dimensions, it's having a hard time making a decision, but if you add a new feature, that's a fourth dimension, the feature space you're working in becomes more complicated, you can draw a different line. And Andy will talk about this more, but under the hood, that's kind of what this kernel parameter does. And we won't talk about it anymore right now. We can also decrease regularization, so that's the other thing. Reduce the number of neighbors, reduce C or change C. So now let's look at an overfitting model, basically the opposite. And this is very mild overfitting. So a more extreme example of overfitting is in the example linked. You basically get a super squiggly line where every single training point is fit perfectly, but anything that's not a training point just does terribly. And so this is obviously a really bad case of overfitting. So here we see, as we add more data, we always get a really low training score, especially compared to the plot up here. We're sitting around 5-ish. Here we're less than 1, probably in the 0.1 range. And as we add more data, we see that the testing score is coming down, 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 down. This is a pretty good indicator that you're overfitting mildly. As you add more and more and more and more training data, the testing error goes down and down and down, because as you grow the training set, you should be able to generalize better, given that the training and testing data come from the same underlying process. So an overfitting model can be improved by getting more training samples. So if you have 10,000 examples, maybe get 100,000. And as long as they're different, they can help you reduce overfitting, because once again, in the limit of infinite data, you should generalize perfectly. Never happens, but that's the concept. You can use a less sophisticated model. In this case, you can turn the kernel down to the right answer, which is poly. You can also change the parameter C to make things more regularized. So these are typically your three options. You have models that are more complicated and models that are less complicated, and the most important thing is to figure out what regime you're in, because if you have a model that's underfitting and you try to underfit more, that's not going to help. And you also don't want to go out into the field and gather a bunch more training samples and spend money and time and find out that, oh, I was in the wrong regime in the first place. So in summary, I pretty much talked about this, but if you're underfitting, you want to add more samples, use a more complicated model, use fewer samples, or decrease regularization. Because generally when you're underfitting, you want the model to become more complex, or you want to give it more ways to make a more complex decision. In the overfitting regime, you want to use less features, or a simpler model, or more training samples, or more regularization. Basically, going back to the k-nearest neighbors example, you want to make the decision boundary smoother. Or in the case that we had above, you want to make the estimated sine wave smoother. And that's it for 4.3. So I'll switch it off to Andy, and he will lead you through the guts of some really interesting stuff.
Okay. The question is, what metric is grid search using? And that's what the next section is about. All right, so yeah, we talked about using grid search and cross-validation for model evaluation, but sort of until now we used the default score, so accuracy for classification and R-squared for regression. And there's a lot of other metrics. I want to discuss some of them and when to use which. So here, this is just a small recap on other ways to introspect a model. I trained a linear support vector machine, linear SVC, on the digit data set, so this 10-class classification data set, and we have the score number, and that is just the accuracy, and that's what we looked for. We also looked at, we can look at a confusion matrix. Kyle went through this a little bit, which tells us which digits are likely to be confused, and we want to have a diagonal, and the off-diagonals tell us which were confused. For example, here, the 8 and the 9, for example, are more or less easily confused. And yeah, we also had this plot. There's also a function called classification report, which will give you also more insight into classification, in particular multi-class classification. it will report two numbers. So there's four numbers that are important, which are called true positives. So this is for binary classification. So true positives, you have a positive and a negative class. True positives are ones that are actually positive and are also predicted as such. False positives are the ones that are predicted as the positive class but are actually negative. True negatives are the ones that are predicted as the negative class and actually belong to that. And false negatives are the ones that are predicted as negative but are positive. So these are the four numbers in the confusion matrix for a two-class classification problem. And two numbers that are often looked at and that you can compute from these are precision and recall. Precision means for the ones that you predict as positive, what is the fraction of these that are actually positive? Recall means how many of these that are positive did you actually get? And a classification report gives you for each of the classes precision and recall. And the F1 score, which is the harmonic mean between precision and recall, so it's a kind of a trade-off. It also tells you the support, which is how many of this class are in the data set, so in the test set here. And then it gives you the average over these classes. And this can give you some intuition about which classes are hard to predict, which ones are easy to predict. And this is like often very helpful to look at if you're interested in have different costs for different classes. So, but often we also want to firstly summarize things more succinctly than having a large diagram with lots of numbers to look at. And also we maybe want to be more explicit in what does cost mean for us. What a thing that happens very frequently is that you have very imbalanced classes. Say you have 9 or 10 times the amount of data in one class than the other class. If you do at-click prediction, maybe like 0.1 or 0.001% of your ads actually get clicked on, and so one of the classes is much, much smaller than the other class. Because who clicks on banner ads? I mean, so I want to do a toy example here where I do a digits classification where I classify digit 3 against all the other digits. So we have a 9-to-1 imbalance in classification. And so let's apply here. This is a kernel support vector machine. Detail is not important. That's a good classifier usually. So if I do cross-fault score on this data set, that is digit 3 versus the rest of the digits, and I get 90% accuracy, is that a good classification or a bad classification? Any ideas?
It's bad.
It's bad because it's as good as guessing? Any other bets? Okay, so the thing is, the most frequent class, the class saying I'm not a 3, is 90% of the data. So if I always say I'm not a 3, which is, there's a thing to debugging like this in scikit-learn, like a dummy classifier that always predicts the most frequent class, that also gets 90%. So it's as good as always saying I'm not a 3. So it seems the classifier is pretty bad. Actually, it depends on where does it make the mistakes, and are the mistakes as stupid as the one that says I'm always a 3? And one way to evaluate what kind of mistakes are made are ROC curves. And so this is a really good tool if you work with imbalanced data. And most of real-world data sets are imbalanced, because often you don't know how to collect a balanced data set. So let me do this plot first. So what a ROC curve does is it works not only with the predicted classes, but with uncertainties in the classification. There's the method that I mentioned before called decision function, which gives you a certainty estimate. And the ROC curve uses that. And what it looks at then is So usually I make a hard decision. If the decision function is greater than 1, greater than 0, I predict it's a 3. If it's smaller than 0, I predict not 3. What happens if I vary the threshold and not make it at 0? What happens if I make it at a higher point? Then you will get less things predicted at as 3. But will these be false positives or false negatives? And so what the ROC curve does is it varies this threshold, and it for each possible threshold, it plots the false positive rate against the true positive rate. So true positive rate is recall. How many of the actual 3s did I get? And false positive rate is how many things did I classify as 3 that were not actually a 3. And here are 3 plots for 3 different settings of the parameter gamma and the SVC. So these are just the 3 different parameter settings. For all 3 of these, the accuracy is 90%. So they're all similarly good with respect to accuracy. Though if you look at these ROC curves, you can see this one, the red one, the number of true positives increases the same as the number of false positives, which is basically chance performance. You want the curve ideally to be as the blue one. You want all true positives without getting any false positives. And so basically the red classifier predicts at chance level. The blue classifier actually is basically perfect because it says it ranks all the 3s higher than all the non-3s. So there is a threshold. If you pick that threshold, all the 3s will have a value above that, and all the non-3s will have a value below that. So it does a perfect job in separating the 3s and the non-3s. The accuracy is not perfect, so that means the threshold is not 0, but there is such a threshold. And so you can see that all of these 3 classifiers have the same accuracy. But one is a chance level and one is perfect, so which tells you that accuracy is a really, really bad measure for measuring imbalanced data sets. And so the one that I usually like to use is the AUC, the area under the ROC curve. And this is just summing up all the space below this curve. Basically, it's the integral over all this curve. It's going to be 0.5 for chance level classification, like the red curve. It's going to be 1 for a blue curve, which is perfect. And if you are pretty good, you have something like the green curve here, which is 0.96. And you can use these kind of scoring methods in CrossWildScore and in GridSearchCV. So these are basically the interesting places where you want to evaluate your model. You give it a scoring parameter. And you can give it just a string. For example, you can give it a string ROC AUC, and it'll use that instead of doing accuracy. And you say that actually the model performs quite well. So one of my favorite ones is this ROC AUC, area under the curve. But there's very many built-in scoring functions. And you can import the scorers and look at the keys. These are the things that are supported. So mean squared error, precision, log loss, ROC score, accuracy, F1, R2, and so on. And you can just give this as a string to scoring in grid search or CrossWild score. You can also give your custom scoring function if you want to be more flexible. It can be either a function or it can be an object that defines a call method. So, for example, if you would want to re-implement accuracy for some reason, you need to specify this function. So, my accuracy scoring, the first thing it gets is a trained model, and then gets the test data and the test labels. And here I do numpy.mean from the prediction of the estimator equal to the test labels. And OK, this is just accuracy. I'm not sure. You could do also something else, like this is maybe, if you look at this, you might think this is a slightly odd interface of giving it an estimator and a data instead of predictions and results. But getting the whole estimator makes it possible for you to be very, very flexible. If you have a linear model and you have coefficients, for example, you could say, maybe I want a model that has very few coefficients that are non-zero. So you want a model that is very sparse. So that is kind of simple in a particular way. Then you can say, I want it to be accurate, but I also want it to be have many coefficients that are equal to zero. And you can define my superscoring. And that does that. And then you can do grid search. With scoring equal to my superscoring. And what I do here is I do a linear SVM on the digits data set, and I search over two different penalties, L1 and L2. I'll explain them actually, I think, in the next notebook. But one of them gives you solutions where the coefficient is often zero and one doesn't. And if you search over this with the grid search and the scoring function, you will get the one that gives you many zeros. Okay. So this is maybe a slightly silly example, but using this, these custom scoring functions, you can build very complex ways to inspect your model into grid search. Any questions? Okay. So I think the next part is going more in depth about particular kinds of models. And we start off with linear models. So I think we mentioned that before, but so linear models for regression are basically the most simple model you can think of. Given your test data, so a single data point with features x test 0 to x test n minus number of features minus 1 are your input features. And linear regression makes a prediction by multiplying each feature with the corresponding coefficient. So there's as many coefficients as there's features. You multiply them and sum them all up. And then you add an intercept, and that is your prediction. So pretty simple. It's like an inner product between vectors plus an intercept. And so let's see, look a little bit on how these models behave. So here we use the learning curve again. We use some synthetic data set that is just basically a linear regression model. So you have some data x that is random normal, and we create a y by multiplying it by some coefficients and add some noise. So this is kind of the learning curve that we saw before a little bit. So if we increase the training set size, the test scores get better and better if you get more training data. But as you get more training data, the training scores might also go down because you have to explain more and more data. And so this is using the most simple model that there is, basically linear regression, which is the simplest model to find the coefficients. It just tries to fit the data. There's more complex models that try to find more simple explanations of the data. And so and that allow you to specify how much you want to trade off overfitting and underfitting. One of them is the rich regression estimator. The rich regression adds to fitting the data a term that says, I want my coefficients to be small. And this is called L2 penalty. And there's a parameter alpha that says, how much do I want my coefficients to be small? And by setting this alpha, if I set it to very high values, I make my model very simple. If I set it to very low values, I make my model very complex. So if it's not a good idea, but if you set alpha to 0, you would get linear regression. And here you can see that if you have very little data, then the test scores for rich are higher because it has a more restricted model. So even if you have less data, it will overfit less to the little data you have. But the training score will be lower because it'll fit less strongly to the data. As you get more and more data, this L2 penalty, this regularization that says my coefficients should be small, means less and less, and so it will become the same as the training score for linear regression. So there's this parameter alpha that you need to pick to say to control model complexity and trade off underfitting versus overfitting. And there's an object that does that for you. Rich CV. It's basically the same as Grid Search CV, only it works in a very efficient way just for rich regression. And this will actually pick the best alpha for you. There's also cross-validation, but in a like smart and fast way. And if you use that, then basically you'll always do better than linear regression. There's also another way to you can penalize the linear model, which is not saying all coefficients should be small, but basically saying only a few of them should be non-zero. So you use only few features to actually predict your target. This is called L1 penalty, and it's implemented in the lasso. So here, we create another synthetic data set where we say only few of the features are important. And if you use that, then you can see that at least if you have very little data, your lasso model does much better in generalizing because it only picks up on the important things. But here, maybe we regularized our lasso model too strongly. This also has a parameter alpha that says how few features should have nonlinear coefficients, and maybe it was too strong here. But there's also the model called lasso CV, which it again does for you the cross-validation and finds the right alpha value. And if you use that, then you see the test score of the lasso are always much better than of the rich model. So this is in particular good if you know most of my features are not important, there's only going to be a few, I don't know which these few are going to be, then I can use a lasso model. And this will work pretty well.
Yeah.
The number of coefficients is constant. Lasso picks which coefficients to use automatically. How many to use based on the data and on the regularization parameter alpha. But the data is always, the number of features in the data is always the same. I add just more features and this plot adds more and more training set data. Does that answer the question?
I think so.
Okay.
Rows, not columns.
Yeah, I add rows, not columns, to the data. Okay. There's another model, which actually, just want to mention briefly, which is called ElasticNet, which has both L1 and L2 penalty. And if you're not sure what to use, just use this. There's a trade-off between the two, which is called L1 ratio, which you might want to grid search over. It says, how much do I want everything to be small, and how much do I want to use few features? So if it's set to 1, it's lasso. If it's set to 0, it's rich, but it can vary smoothly between them. And so if you grid search over this, you search up a whole range of models. Yeah, I think that's all I want to say about it. I'll go over the classification again, and then I'll give you some time for doing the exercise for both the, both the exercises. So in classification, the prediction works very similarly to regression. So you have your features, and you do basically an inner product with the coefficients and add an intercept, only because you're not predicting continuous value, predicting a category, you then threshold it at 0. So this is for binary classification. So if you have two classes, if this outcome is larger than 0, you predict the positive class. If it's smaller than 0, you predict the negative class. And if you have multi-class things, it's slightly more tricky. There's also regularization here. So actually, I want to illustrate this using a slightly different plot. This is my favorite toy data set, which I spent hours creating so that it actually shows off what's happening. So the effect of this is mostly visible in higher dimensions of this regularization of the lasso and the rich, for example. So here I use a linear SVM classifier, which is also a linear classifier. It has this threshold, and it usually uses an L2 penalty. There's a parameter called C that controls how much of this penalty is used. With a small value of c, it's a simple model. With a large value of c, it's a complex model. And if you look at these plots closely, if you have a small value of c, it will mostly be taking into account the mean of the data. So it will be very smooth in the sense that it very much looks at the majority. While if you make the c higher and higher, you can learn more complex things, which means it will try to focus on each individual data point more strongly. So here you can see that this red point is wrongly classified in this setting and is correctly classified in this setting. And depending on what your assumption of the data are, you might prefer the simple explanation, it doesn't makes a mistake, or the complex explanation, it makes one less mistake. So the effect of this in two dimensions is not so strong, but in high dimensions can make a big difference. And so this linear SVC classifier actually has, you can do L1 or L2 regularization depending what you want to do. So the exercise I would like you to do is to use the logistic regression, which is in the linear model package, and then grid search the C parameter to classify the digits. So, okay. And then, so you need to load the digits data set for that, do a train test split, and run grid search. So that's like. Or any questions? No? Okay.
Can we then figure out after the fact which of the features were at all
predictable? So the question is, after we use these methods, can we figure out which features are important? And yes, so in particular, for if you use L1 penalized models, you could check which coefficients are exactly zero. These were not important. Well, the model, with the settings of the parameters that you used, the model thinks these are not important. If you use an L2 penalized model like Rich, then none of the coefficients will be zero, but you can look at which coefficients are large and which are small. If you think back to the text classification, I plotted these coefficients, right? And that's what I did. I inspected the coefficients and looked which are small and which are large. And so the general assumption is that the larger ones are the more important ones. No, it's... Yeah. Yeah, depends. So he says don't do it. I mean, if you do recursive feature elimination with the linear model, which you can do, then it'll make this assumption and drop out the feature has the smallest coefficient. So if you use an L2 penalized model, I would say be careful in not overinterpreting it. If you use an L1 penalized model, if the coefficient is zero, the model is not using this feature. If the model does well without using this feature, then it's probably not important. So the comment was, if you have collinear features, or maybe you have the same feature twice in the data set, L1 might pick one of the features and not the other one, and it will be random, so they're identical. And so it says one is important, the other is not, even though they're the same. Yes, that can happen. It doesn't hurt, but you can't interpret the coefficients. So your question was, how do I know which features are important? It says one of the features is not important. Even, like, let's say you have two features that are both just a target. I'll want a regularized model, pick a coefficient of one for one of them and zero for the other one. So it says the one that's perfectly the target is not important because it already explained it. So this, you see how this can... You should not say this is not important. It's the target. It's very important. But I mean, there's things that there's randomized lasso and randomized logistic regression in scikit-learn that are a bit more robust in trying to get you which features are important. And that might work better. Okay, the question was, someone gives you a data set, doesn't tell you what it is, and you try all classifiers, and you can't get a decent outcome. Can you from that conclude that the data is not, that you cannot predict this target from the data set? No, probably, I don't know. It depends.
Say the outcome is sales of shoes at Amazon, right?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes you cannot predict.
And all the features are rain in Albania, salary of
the top engineer. They use rain in Albania to predict the sales of the shoes. I wasn't a team, but so from knowing that a particular model or even 20 models that you tried didn't work, you cannot say it's not in the data. I wouldn't claim that. I mean, it can be that you can. So if you want to predict gender from the last name, you're out of luck. That's not going to work because the information is just not there. You cannot learn something that is just not there. But claiming that it's not there is kind of hard to defend. There might be a very complex relationship in the data that you just don't know, and maybe that's not in your hypothesis class. And, I mean, if you try to predict something from an image, like using the raw pixel values, you'll have a very, very hard time. And if someone didn't tell you it was an image, you're probably not going to succeed. But still, the information is there. So if someone gave you, there's this popular data set called ImageNet. If someone gave you the data set, and these are all like 256 times 256 images. Someone flattened them all out. Actually, let's say they also permuted the pixels in a way that you don't know. So now, I don't know a machine learning algorithm that would be able to work them. If you knew the permutation, you could permute the pixels back, use a computer vision approach, and you can do pretty well. Okay. So the information is still there. If you know the secret permutation, that a convolutional net can be applied to. Okay. Anyhow. So is anyone actually doing the exercise? Please raise your hand if you do the exercise. Has anyone finished the exercise? Okay. I'll answer random questions and we'll go on in like 3 minutes.
Is there an assumption of the data being on the same scale in order to use Ridge and Lasso?
Yeah, so there's basically, actually I think Ridge does, I think maybe even both Ridge and Lasso would have checked parameters do normalization by default. So there's a parameter in Lasso. Here, let's look. That says whether to do to normalize or not. Normalize equals to false. Okay, by default, it's a bit inconsistent which normalize by default and which don't. It's probably a good idea to do normalization. I think Ridge does it by default. Okay, maybe it's a good idea to normalize because the regularization kind of will be stronger for the things that have a larger scale. So either set normalize to true or use standard scalar. Okay, maybe a hint I should have given for the exercise is use C's on a logarithmic scale as we did before. So if you try for C 1, 2, 3, 4, you'll probably not see a big difference, but if you do something like a logarithmic scale, you might see more of a difference. All right, so the solution looks something like this. It's all things that we had before. It's just sort of, I'd like to hammer them in. So for the grid search, we define our parameter grid as a dictionary where the keys are the parameters we want to adjust. So we want to adjust the C parameter or logistic regression. The value is the list of values you want to try. We load the digits data set, do a training and test split so that we can evaluate on test split later on. Grid search CV gets the model, logistic regression, parameter grid, and also something that we haven't mentioned before is there's an ndrops parameter sometimes, which lets you use multiple cores. And ndrops equals to minus one means use all the cores. This is embarrassingly parallel, so the different parameter settings can be done completely in parallel. So supposedly this is faster. And I'm surprised this is, okay, maybe I shouldn't be surprised that it's slow. That's crazy. Okay, then we fit on a training set, score on test set. I thought it would be instantaneous. Who came up with a similar solution? Cool. Okay. I'm really confused that this takes so long. Is there something wrong with the... maybe it's because of OS X and parallelization? I don't know. Okay. Never mind. So let's move on. So the other thing I want to talk about, the next model class, is support vector machines, which are kind of similar to linear SV. So they're kind of similar to linear models, but they're a bit more general. They're a class of models that are super powerful. They're kind of slow. If you have like more than 100,000 data points, don't use them, I think. But they often work very well. They're kind of susceptible to parameter tuning, so you definitely need to do a grid search to tune parameters. The linear models, it's not that bad. So their SVMs are implemented in the SVC class, and they have what is called kernel functions. If you set kernel to linear, you'll get the linear SVC, which is a linear model as we talked about before. But if you use a nonlinear kernel like Poly or RBF, you'll get a much more powerful model. And so I gave the mathematical formulation of how to do a prediction here. It's slightly complex, but there's also an easy interpretation. So let's say you have this Y is... who here has never seen a sum sign? Oh, very good. Okay, you have some training data xy with labels yi, and you have a new data point and you want to classify x. And a kernel function is some k here that tells you how close is your training data point and xj to your new point x. And if it's close, you probably want to give it the same label, yj. That seems kind of intuitive. Like, if they're close, they should have the same label. And the thing that you actually learn are these coefficients here, these alpha j, which say how important is each data point for this for making this decision. And if you tell any SVM person, that's how I explain that, they'll hit me to death. You can also think about this as a linear estimator in an infinite dimensional space, but I don't feel that that's helpful. Okay, usually there's only a few of these alphas are non-zero, so you use a couple of points, the distance to these points, and try to assign labels based on that. And there's two important parameters. So sign here just means if it's positive, it's plus one, it's negative, it's minus one, something like that. Okay, so there's two important parameters, the C, which is similar to the linear models. High values mean... a very complex model, and also each model can have as much influence as it wants, which usually leads to only a few points taking all the responsibility. Low values mean each point can only have a limited amount of influence. So this is, actually goes back very much to this plot. So low values of C mean points can have only very limited influence each individual. High values mean every individual point can have a lot of influence. The other parameter is for the RBF kernel, which is a kernel that works in many, many problems, is the gamma kernel, is the gamma parameter. It's something like the inverse bandwidth. So this is like a Gaussian kernel. Looks like this. You probably have seen this. And gamma just says how wide it is. So how close should points be together to be considered close? And you should really apply grid search to both of these parameters, gamma and c, because they often interact. And because it was a bit abstract, I made this little widget here, which is my hand-designed data set. And you can adjust c and gamma here. So these these points with the big black circle around it are the support vectors. These are the ones that make up the decision function. And the rate of the rest of the training data doesn't basically is ignored in a way, or is deemed not important for learning this concept. And if you make c higher, maybe not. Well, okay. First, let's make c lower. Then you'll see that you get more and more support vectors because each point can't take as much responsibility. Also, everything will become smoother. If you make gamma higher, everything will become more round because, like, neighbors mean something like much broader. So everything becomes very smooth. If you do it a lot, then you'll end up with a linear function, basically. Shrinking.
Well, yeah, but it was also enclosing some of those points. But am I incorrect in saying that, you know, as it gets larger, that boundary becomes a line? Or does it remain a boundary in space?
Wait, I don't know. So this is always a boundary between two regions.
Right. But if you keep it making it smaller, you can see that it encloses some of the
points. Yeah. Actually, I think, I'm not sure. This might be that I didn't... push commits. I think it might be that there's less blue points here than red points. I tried to fix that, but maybe it's not in this version I'm using here. So if you make C smaller and smaller, each point can have less and less influence. And if we make it infinitely small and you have one more red point than blue point, then everything will be red. Because that's how it's I mean, that's what the math will do. Ideally, it will just basically become a line. Okay. So if you make the gamma larger, the bandwidth becomes smaller. And then sort of each individual point will get its own little sea of blue or red. You can see this here, maybe. You can see here that this point basically has its own little area here. And so this makes large C's makes it very wobbly, and large C's make it also very wobbly, but in kind of slightly different ways. Okay. Yeah. So actually, I had an exercise here where maybe we'll skip that, which is, you can do the same grid search we just did for the logistic regression. We can do it for the SVM, where we search over both C and gamma. There's plenty of examples of this on the website. So the next, or are there questions about SVMs or anything? Okay. The next thing I wanted to talk about are tree-based models in forests. So tree-based models are a class of models that are very robust and pretty easy to understand. So what they do is basically they ask a series of questions which is yes and no answers, and depending on what the answers are, they make a prediction. So here's, like here in the string, there's this example of, if you want to classify an animal, you can ask questions like, is it smaller than a meter? How many horns does it have? How many feet does it have? How many wings does it have? And depending on these, you can make a decision on which kind of animal it is. So you ask a series of yes and no questions. And you can think of these as building this decision tree. And you branch off. You can use these, for example, for regression. And I think we have a sine wave here again. Do we have a sine wave? Yes, we have kind of a sine wave. And so the point here is that this series of questions is learned from the data. So it will try to come up with the best set of questions to explain the data. And so here you can see what it does for another little sine wave example. Basically, it splits the data into regions that all have the same answers for all of your questions, and it will predict one number on this part. You can see sort of this point here has sort of a particular answer to, I guess here the questions are, where do you lie on the x-axis, because there's only one feature, and then sort of the points that lie in the same regime get the same answer, which is the mean of the points. I feel it's a bit more, it's a bit nicer to see what's happening if you do classification. Here I have a red versus blue classification, and so this is sort of, the questions you ask are always about a single feature at a time, which means that you get these rectangular decisions. And there's a problem with trees is that they usually overfit a lot. So they concentrate a lot on the training data, which you can see here. You can see this very like narrow red bands going everywhere because there was a single training data point there. Because basically, you can always ask more and more questions to be more and more specific, and then in the end, you will only end up with a single point. And that is like why they overfit. One thing you can do is you can limit the depth of the tree. And so here I have this data set again, and where I try to learn red versus blue. And if I build a tree, yeah. Also, you did not update your notebooks here. I'm pretty sure I caught this error. Okay, I'm sorry about that. Yeah, but I meant PyDot's not in a check script, which is kind of bad, but also I made it not return error, just not plot it. But it seems that the version is not here. I hope it's in the repository. Sorry if you don't get the plot. It makes me kind of sad because it was awesome. Ah, okay. You can install PyDot if you want, and if you all install it at the same time, it would work very well. Can I just pip install minus u? Yeah? Okay. That's not... Why does it do that? I'm sad. Okay, yeah, that's a good idea. Snack break until 10 past 3. There's snacks. You're brilliant. If you start growing deeper trees, it will cut off more parts. And so the colors here change a little bit. The colors encode certainties. And so it will be very certain in these regions. It becomes more certain as the as you grow deeper and deeper in the tree, it will add more and more. So here, this is a slightly uncertain region. So the tree goes deeper, has more leaves, becomes more and more complex. It will be able to explain more and more of the training data, but it will also overfit more and more. Until the trees become very deep and explain the data perfectly, but probably don't generalize very well. So you wouldn't expect the point that is lying here to be red. I would expect it to be blue. But it says this very high certainty that it's red. So one of the ways to overcome this overfitting is just set a smaller maximum depth. The problem is that these trees are, with small depth, cannot express very complex concepts. So here, for example, I mean, there's a slightly diagonal line maybe here. So maybe I would draw a decision boundary here somewhere, but the tree can't really express that without being too deep. And so a way to avoid this overfitting is to use multiple trees in a bagging approach. So one way to use multiple trees is random forests. What random forests do is you select random subsets of the data, build a tree on this data, and also in each split, you consider only a subset of the features. So you do two random selections. So for each tree, you do a random subset of the data, and for each split, you do some random subset of the features. And this way, each individual tree becomes different from the other trees. And so they're overfit in different ways into different data sets. And so if you average their predictions, the overfitting will average out, and it will give you better and more smoother estimates. So what I do here is, I forgot how many trees I used, but I guess like something like 50 or 100 trees that I built on different subsets. So just using the random forest classifier, this will build the trees for you. And you can see that if you make the depths larger and larger, it will tend not to overfit as much, and it will give you a smoother prediction surface. Still, if you make them too deep, you will still be able to overfit. And so for using trees, it's usually better, for using random forests, usually better to use as many trees as possible. So there's this parameter n estimators that tells you how many trees. More trees will always be better. So they will be more expensive to compute, more expensive to learn. And you can see like at some point there's diminishing returns, but just pick a large number. And maybe if you can afford it, try a larger number. The important parameters here are how many features to sample in each split. You can give it just a number of samples, number of features to use. Here, I just picked 10 as one value that it could try. There's good heuristics, so for example, just using square root of number of features. So I have 64 features here, so I could just use 8. I think that's the default. Or using logarithmic is also like a thing people often try. The other one is to regularize each tree. You can do the maximum depth, as I demonstrated above in the plots. There's also different ways, like the maximum number of leaves or how many points you need to do a split. But maximum depth always often works well. So if you want to do a grid search to adjust the classifier, the random forest classifier, should definitely search over max depth, possibly also over max features. And don't search over number of estimators. Just pick a large enough number. And this is a very slow laptop, I remember. And you see that even with the best parameters found by grid search, it still basically learned the training set by heart. This is on a digits data set, but it does pretty well on a test set. Any questions on random forests? Okay. Or trees? So another way to combine trees is what's called gradient boosting. This is usually slower than random forests. It's a bit trickier to tune, and but usually works a bit better. What it does is it trains a tree to predict the outcome, and how does it? So it trains a single tree, looks how well it does in predicting the outcome, and then trains another tree on the residual, so on the parts that were not predicted already. And so this is a, instead of kind of just bagging together all these all the trees, it kind of incrementally builds a stronger and stronger model by adding trees to the parts that were not correctly predicted yet. And again, here you can use maximum depth to regularize how deep each tree is. I think usually you use very shallow trees, like depth 2 maybe, or even 1, and how many trees you want to have. Here, it's important to like pick a good number of estimators, or in particular, number of estimators and learning rate are two features that two parameters that interact a lot. Learning rate is how strong you believe each tree that you add. So if you pick a high learning rate, you might need less estimators. If you pick a low learning rate, you might need more estimators. I don't think we have that much time, but I mean, a good exercise would be to do optimize the learning rate here. Like, for a fixed number of estimators, optimize the learning rate and the max depth with gradient boosted trees. But here, for gradient boosted trees, so if you have to train them one by one, and random forest you can train in parallel, gradient boosting is often slower. I think that's the important part, but it's often faster, it's usually faster for prediction. All right. And it's like super popular for Kaggle competitions and stuff. This was like the... Sorry? When I learn the model, the random forest is much faster. When I predict, the gradient boosting is faster. And because the gradient boosting often uses less and smaller trees. And in terms of accuracy, gradient boosting is also better often. But it's harder to tune. If you want win Kaggle, use gradient boosting. If you want to make something work in a data set quickly, use random forests. Okay, so that was like the in-depth of the different of three classes of models. The last thing I want to talk about is pipelining estimators. So the question was, if gradient boosting models have shallower trees and fewer trees, maybe I can give this more to a non-expert and they can interpret it. I think it will still be, like on any reasonably sized data set, one that will perform well will not be easy enough to be interpretable. There's things to interpret the models, but more like how important is each feature, how much adding each feature help. And there's some more things about this in the documentation. And there's like this feature importances and so on. But actually, like understanding the whole model is unrealistic. There will be probably hundreds of trees, and you probably can't understand that. So even single trees, if they're deep, they're hard to understand. But they often work very well. Oh, one thing I should add about trees. So they don't care about scaling of the data at all. It's equivalent if you scale your data or not. They just find threshold. Basically, they look at each feature separately, so relative differences don't matter. And for each feature, they try out all possible thresholds. And so how you scale doesn't matter at all. So that's the thing that's very good about trees. You don't really need to pre-process your data.
How do I get a diagonal
How do you get a diagonal linear decision boundary with the tree? You don't. Still, they work very well in practice. So there are some people that, I mean, you could do it with, but you would need a very deep tree. You could do a step function, right? If you do it infinitely deep, you can get an infinitely smooth step function. Well, you could rotate your data, but you don't know how to rotate in advance. I mean, there's things, there are people using models that actually have a linear model in each leaf, so you could do that, but they don't usually work in general. They're not widely used. This works in practice very well. It doesn't work so well if you have a lot of sparse features, so I wouldn't use that on text directly. Yeah, we had this kind of in the morning, but we kind of skipped it because we ran out of time. So categorical variables. Trees, in principle, can work with categorical variables. The ones currently in scikit-learn don't. Hopefully we fix it soon. So for categorical variables in all of scikit-learn, you need to do one-hot encoding. That means if you have a thing that is a field that's called color and can be red, green, and blue, you have to add three features, one that says, is it red, one that says, is it green, one that says, is it blue. And that's what you need to do for all of the scikit-learn models. And basically, for most of the models, you don't have a choice in doing this anyhow. Trees could, in principle, work with the categorical representation, but the scikit-learn ones can't at the moment. Question is, for the random forest, is there a maximum number of features you should use? So I think in general, it doesn't work as well with a lot of very sparse features. If they're dense, no, you can use them with arbitrary many features. I mean, I think people use it on fairly high dimensional data sets. It's going to be slower and large in memory. You should definitely limit the depth. If you don't limit the depth by default, it will grow the tree until all leaves are pure. And if you have a lot of features and a lot of samples, this will be very deep. And it will probably not generalize. Okay.
One general question. Having used a supervised learning method and done all of this on computer models, now, at the next stage, right, once we are able to predict and given a new set of features, what is it likely to be, right? Then is there a scope for using clustering or something else on the features to determine what is it about, let's say it's a binary classification thing. We are trying to identify teams in the game. So maybe there's age and height and diet and various things that go into this mix. But eventually, given a new team, I can tell you with this thing how likely it is to win a soccer game. Now, I would like to know, what is it about the teams which win?
Okay, so I think, so the question is basically, given, I learned a model on some data set, and if I give a new test data, it'll give me a prediction, and I want to know why does it do this prediction. And that is, depends on the model, how hard. So, I mean, if you have a tree-based model, there's ways to compute feature importances, and they might or might not be meaningful. If you have a linear model, you could try to interpret the coefficients. You might not want to interpret the coefficients. It's not a problem that you can solve in general. If you use a kernel support vector machine, basically you cannot say anything about the features. You can say this point is similar to this training point, and that's why it was classified as such and such. It's probably an open research question that has not been really well addressed yet. There's no general solution. And usually, like, simpler models are easier to interpret, but will always lose out. Sometimes, if you need to explain why something happened to your boss, don't use a gradient boosting tree. Or tell him, if you really want it good, you don't want a decision that I can explain to you. And if you can convince them of that, then you can use a gradient boosted tree or a neural network. But then you'll never find out why it did what it did.
Which is a great segue to the next question. Where in scikit-learn is neural network?
Okay, the question is, where's neural networks? Currently, it's not there. It will be there. It will only be a multi-layer perceptron. We will not add any GPU support. Read the FAQ why. We don't want to depend on CUDA. And so use Lasagna or Keras or sklearn Theano or something else.
They used to have one. They took it
out. Scikit-learn?
Yeah,
it used to have neural networks a very, very long time ago, before they worked on any problem. okay, let's go on to the pipelining stuff. I mean, we'll also stick around later if you want to ask some more questions. But we have some more things to cover. So, pipelining. I think we mentioned it briefly before. This is about... Usually you don't have to just build a classifier. You often need to use pre-processing or feature extraction or feature selection or any of a combination of these two. And we had this example of the SMS spam stuff, doing text feature extraction. Okay, here I just load the data set again. So we had this SMS text, spam or ham. And so this is the solution that we came up with before. We had our TF-IDF vectorizer or count vectorizer and a logistic regression. We had the text data. We fit the TF-IDF vectorizer to the text data. It'll build this whole dictionary. Then we use the dictionary to transform it to this large sparse matrix representation. We do this to the training and the test data set. Then we do we instantiate our logistic regression or a classifier, give it the transformed data set, the training labels, and score on the transformed data set and the training labels. So I fit the feature extraction, transform using the feature extraction, fit the classifier, and score with the classifier. And this situation, this is basically the default case. It's very rare that you want to just apply classifier. There's usually some pre-processing step. And pipelines in scikit-learn make this for you much easier. So here's exactly the same thing. Well, let me run this. Here's exactly the same thing, only it takes much fewer lines. So this is one advantage of using pipelines. So here, make pipeline uses a transformer and a classifier, and it changes them together. And then I can input into this new object, this pipeline object, the raw text data and the training labels to fit, and the raw test data and test labels to score. And what it will do is exactly the thing above. So it'll fit the transformer, transform using the transformer, and fit the other model. If I call score, it'll just transform and then score. And I can have an arbitrary many transform objects. So I could use like some feature extraction, feature selection here, or some PCA, or some standard scaler, and I could make a very long list, and I'll fit all of these and transform and put the output of one step as an input into the next step. So this is nice as a shortcut for a common pattern, but it's much more important than that. One thing is that if you have this pipeline and you want to do grid search using cross-validation, if you do this just on the last step, you have a problem. Because let's say I call fit with my training data set on the TF-IDF vectorizer. And then I give the transformed version to grid search. Ah, I think I actually have this here. So this illustrates a common mistake. Don't use this code. This is how to do it wrong. So I get the TF-IDF vectorizer. I get my training data set. I transform my training data set and my test data set. And now I use grid search on the training set. This does the cross-validation, gives me best parameters, and so on. What is wrong with this? OK, so the problem with this is that I gave the vectorizer the whole training set. This means I gave it also, in the cross-validation, the part that will be the test fold. I want, in this cross-validation, like 4/5 will be training set, 1/5 will be test set. The vectorizer also saw the test set. The TF-IDF remembers how often each word appeared and reweights the data with that. It also saw the test folds. So it will not. So this is called contamination, I think it's mostly by statistics people. So your results in a cross-validation actually include some knowledge of the test set. And obviously, you want to avoid that. So what you actually want to do is you want to know your cross-validation around your whole pipeline, your whole feature extraction, transformation, and so on. So if this is just removing the mean, it's kind of statistically bad, but maybe that doesn't have that bad an impact. If you do this for feature selection, it will be very, very bad, because you already use your test set a lot. So, and the right way to do this is you just build a pipeline out of all your steps, then fit the pipeline into the grid search. Call fit on the pipeline, score on the pipeline. That's shorter, and it actually gives you like a valid estimate. There's one slight thing to notice is when I specify the parameters to search over in the grid search, I have to tell it which step of the pipeline to use. And so here I have this logistic regression step in which I want to adjust the C. So I have to tell it logistic regression double underscore C. It's always the lowercase class name, double underscore parameter name. And that's just sort of a convention. No. Okay. So, did I put this here? No. It doesn't mean you can't. There's a two-part answer to this. And maybe I can control this Mac. So the first part of this answer is make pipeline as a shortcut. And I hate the non-shortcutted version, so I didn't show it. There's a class called pipeline. This is actually what makePipeline will return. And it gets a name, which is a string. And then an object. And then here. This way, you can give explicit names. So the string here in front is the explicit name, and this is the logistic regression it. So by default, the name will be the lowercase class name. If you reuse the class, it'll just add dash 0, dash 1, and so on. So it'll automatically create non-duplicate class names. Or you can use the slightly longer syntax and give it explicit names. All right. So, okay, yeah, so lowercase class name, double underscore, parameter name, and then it does the right thing. So this is like a slight illustration here. I'm not going to zoom out for it. Basically, do cross-validation over all your steps. Otherwise, you might get too optimistic estimates or bad parameter settings. The other thing that's cool about using pipelines and cross-validation is you can adjust the parameters of the pre-processing. So if you remember the text data set, we played around with like n-gram range or min-df or something like that. So we can also do this in the grid search here. So I have in a logistic regression, I want to adjust a C parameter. And for a TF-LDF vectorizer, I might want to adjust the n-gram range. And I want to see, is it good to use 1 grams, 1 grams and 2 grams, 1 grams and bigrams, or I think they're called unigrams. Okay, unigrams, and bigrams, or just bigrams. And I can do grid search over that. And this laptop really likes me. The problem, obviously, is as you add more and more preprocessing steps, and they all have parameters, and grid search CV does the combination of all possible combinations. So for each parameter you add, basically it adds exponentially more time, so it gets slower and slower. But you might get a better model in the end. So I'm not sure. Do we want to do an exercise? Is that too complicated? Maybe that's too complicated. You can. These are for the interested reader. There's take-home exercises here. And I think we want to finish with a case study of doing large-scale text classification. Or Any questions about pipelines? Yeah? So pipelines doesn't know anything about cross-validation. It just wraps stuff into one thing, like many steps into a single estimator object. So the question is there a way to do bootstrapping? And so what exactly do you mean? So usually we had some bootstrapping thing, but it's kind of non-standard. So I actually talked with the Carrot people, what they do in bootstrapping, there's no reference for it. So in statistics, bootstrapping usually means you subsample your data set multiple times. In machine learning, you usually want a training and a test set, and they should be disjoint. And you could do like, there are several ways in which you could do bootstrap both a training and a test set that are disjoint, but that's not really a standard method, so we kind of removed it. So what is it you want to do? Okay. That is actually slightly different than the bootstrapping that we did. It's very easy to implement it yourself. I mean, you can do. Yes, you can. I mean, you need to implement a CV object which returns the pairs, and which returns the bootstrap, the indices of a bootstrap sample, and the indices of a test set, and. I can tell you later more about this, but hopefully there's a section about how to build cross-validation objects, but I don't think there is. Okay, but you can do it very easily, and then you can do CV like equal to my bootstrapping thing, and then it'll work. So you ask about confidence intervals or infinite. So, but you said clustering. So you want confidence intervals for clustering?
Well, for example, with the principal component analysis, when you plot the two principal components or the first two scores, for example, oftentimes you look for clusters in that data, and you look for outliers, and it's helpful if you can draw a confidence ellipse around that data to help you identify these outliers.
So there's a method called. So the question was, how do you find outliers with confidence intervals? There's a thing called elliptic envelope that gives you like some estimate of your covariance matrix and identifies outliers. That's a very simple model. The thing is, scikit-learn, so that's probably the right thing for your use case. In general, scikit-learn doesn't provide confidence intervals for most things because they're A, not really available for most of the methods, and B, machine learning people are not so interested in them. Because we are more interested in the predictive capability of a model than to know what exactly the coefficients are. Usually, if you use something like stats model, it'll give you confidence intervals for each coefficient. But that's like, you can't do that for a random forest or a support vector classifier. It's not meaningful. So we don't do that. Okay. Any pipeline related questions? Otherwise, I'll hand over to Kyle.
Okay, so we have one example left to go. It's a large-scale case study on text classification. Before I say that, I'll say a few things about the stuff Andy's just been talking about. One, we talked about doing your own cross-validation object, and this is a nice time to plug the scikit-learn mailing list. Scikit-learn mailing list is very helpful. Pretty much all of the core contributors and a bunch of people who just use the package a lot or have done weird strange things and pushed it kind of to its limits are all kind of there. And so if you had to do something like implement your own cross validation thing, you can't find enough documentation, that's a good place to start raising questions about how do I do this. And if it becomes something common, then we can add documentation to the website. So that's actually a really good thing to do. And as far as like interpretability versus automation. So at the very start when I was doing the introduction, I talked about kind of the spectrum of what machine learning is called. And it goes everywhere from like computational statistics all the way to super automation. So when you get into things like interpreting the model, that to me falls more on the statistical side of things. You're trying to analyze and interpret and discover underlying factors for a process or something. Who figure out why a team won a game or what physical process is driving some scientific process. And on the other side of the spectrum is automation, right? I have something that's easy for humans to do and it's hard for machines to do, and I want to automate it. So to me, at least, scikit-learn kind of falls on the automation side of the spectrum with a little bit of, hey, I can do feature engineering and I can do things to put my knowledge into the models. And if you go all the way to the other end, you hit like crazy, crazy neural networks where features aren't a thing and you just want to cram data in and compute for a long time. So there's kind of this huge range of everything that's called machine learning. So depending on what you're interested in, you can use that to focus on kind of the subset that's useful for you. And if you're doing like medical studies or these kind of really intricate things, sometimes you need interpretability, you need statistics. If you're recognizing cats and dogs, no one cares. You just want to find the dogs. So with that, I will go to the text classification example. So here we're going to kind of show a bag of words, which we talked about a little bit earlier. We won't go into mixed numerical and categorical data. There is a notebook 036 on Titanic if you're interested in how to treat categorical and numerical data and classify things together. Take a look at that. But this will be basically categorical bag of words type stuff. So there's a number of scalability issues that come out of using Count Vectorizer and TF-IDF Vectorizer. And primarily that comes into having to look at all of the data to figure out vocabulary, loading up string representations. A lot of times you need like an intermediate representation that's very large and sparse, hopefully, but still very large. And just even for a lot of problems, having to look at all of the data before you can do anything is hard. So you can imagine a case where if you had some oracle that had previously built a vocabulary over the whole, say, English dictionary, and that was done and that was fixed, then if you got a new data set in, you don't have to read through your whole training set to figure out the vocabulary. You have a vocabulary, it's done already. So here we'll actually talk about a method called the hashing vectorizer that uses some neat mathematical tricks to basically give you this. And the big advantage of this is you can, let's say your data set doesn't fit in memory or doesn't even fit on a hard drive for a single computer. You can actually distribute the data set over a whole bunch of computers and use the same vocabulary on different computers and combine the results at the end and get the same answer. Whereas if you had to go through the whole data set once to build a vocabulary, you would have to start on one machine, build a vocabulary, move to the next machine, go through the data, go through the data, go through the data, go through the data. So that's when you kind of get into the realm of, I really don't like saying it, but I keep saying it anyways, big data. So when you, don't say those words. We want to deal with medium data or small data. Big data is a separate problem. And if you get into that realm, best of luck. So with that, we talked about memory usage, parallelization problems. It's also impossible to do out-of-core stuff because you have to do one pass over the training data with the default text vectorizer, and that is super frustrating if you're always getting new stuff all the time. And there's ways to deal with it, like unknown tags or things like this, but it's really kind of frustrating. So in a minute, we will show off the hashing vectorizer. But for now, let's go over a refresher of what the count vectorizer does. So we have a string, the cat sat on the mat, we fit our vectorizer to it, and we say, okay, we have this mapping of cat goes to 0, mat goes to 1, on goes to 2, sat goes to 3, and the goes to 4. So now we have a mapping basically into a feature space that says, hey, I can, if I have the word cat in my string, this feature will be on. If I have the word mat in my data, this feature will be on, and so on and so forth. And usually you'll have an extra feature over here that's unknown, or you'll strip out characters that you haven't seen before for test data. So let's check this out. So yeah, if we're doing counts, then it's not just 1 or 0. We're counting the number of times that something shows up. So we have cat twice here, so it shows up twice here. And the shows up twice, so it shows up here. Then we go to a larger corpus. Kind of do the same thing. There's an interesting, it's not a law, but it kind of, it's a rule about how text data is distributed. So it's something called Zipf's law. And so you see that, like, there are words in most languages that occur very frequently, and there are words in languages that occur very rarely. So you have like an exponential distribution of the count of words in a large enough corpus. So you run into this problem where you have really, really rare words that might actually be really descriptive. Like if someone does a review and they say your blender is exquisite, that's a very strong sentiment, right? That's really positive. But if you haven't seen exquisite in your training data, you don't know what it means and you have to throw it out. So there's this trade-off of how big is my vocabulary versus I need to encode all of these things so that I can make a good prediction. But if the vocabulary is huge, I can't fit it in memory and I can't compute it. And then you get back to having every word that's ever existed and its misspellings, and that doesn't work either. So these are the kind of trade-offs you have when you deal with text data. So here we kind of show the same example we had before with a larger set of vocabulary. So let's look at some sentiment analysis here. If you ran the fetch data script correctly, all this stuff should be fine. Someone actually thought pretty hard and made a smart data set by looking at smiley faces and frowny faces in a tweet and using that as the label. So if someone has a smiley face in the tweet, it's probable that it's a positive sentiment. If they have a frowny face, it's probable that it's a negative sentiment. Now there's like sarcasm and like fake smileys and like, oh, I hope you die, smiley face. Like those are hard to deal with, right? But as a first pass, this is kind of good for labeling things. So let's just look at the data set, look at how big it is, where it's stored, this kind of stuff. And there's this kind of gnarly chunk of code that does the CSV parsing. You see a bunch of stuff to handle Python 2 and Python 3 file reading. This isn't really too important. It's just kind of here's an example of if you wanted to parse real data, how could you do it? Internally, we use the dict reader to count things up and look at the positive and negative polarity, if you will, and build a data set. I think Andy has broken my laptop. What? It's slower and slower and slower. Maybe so. It's unhappy with a full day of training, but that's okay. There we go, it's done. 18.9 seconds, not that long. Okay, so we want to display the first few samples of our data set and check out what it's saying. So we also have winky faces that could have been labels too. If you are into the data set collection part, something that's nice is to look at the way other people solve problems and think if there's a way to implicitly get labels for your problem rather than strictly using unsupervised methods. And the only way really to do that is by having a lot of domain expertise and thinking pretty hard about what a label means for you. In this case, it seems like the smiley faces could give us something interesting. So we have like a scale of polarity between 0 and 4, or zero is negative, four is super positive, and then like one and two are slightly negative and slightly positive. I don't know exactly what that's. Okay, all the positive tweets are at the end of the file. And apparently, not everything is accurate. I don't know if I would classify that as positive, personally. It's kind of like aggressive, which is an independent axis from positive and negative. So yeah, it looks more like minus one is negative polarity and plus one is positive polarity. So this text is a little misleading. So here we once again do train test splits using a 50% split size. So we have 100,000 tweets for the train, about 100,000 for the test. So we have to update some of this text to be more accurate. So now to the hashing trick. So this is kind of an interesting trick. It's a little bit more involved, but it's actually really useful in a wide variety of applications. So briefly, we talked about the vectorizers in some depth. Tokenize, break it into independent words, build a vocabulary over all the documents, and then each feature is basically either a count or an indicator of the word, or if you use TF-IDF, maybe it's a reweighted number. But fundamentally, our features are words. It's a bag of words, for an example. No ordering is preserved. So one of the limitations is that we would have to look through the whole data set. So instead of doing that, we know that people have written hash functions for strings forever. So we can take a string, hash it, and we can be fairly certain that that hash representation is fairly independent, but it's a mapping. It's a unique mapping. So if we look at the string this and we hash it, that goes to a particular number, in this case, 832,412. If we hash this again, we get the same value, same value, same value, same value. And if a hash is written well, these numbers for most or all possible strings should be evenly distributed over probably the space of like 32-bit integers or something. So this is the job of, like, to some extent, crypto people and also people that generate fast hashes and these kinds of things. So one of the things we can actually do, if we think that this actually gives us a uniform distribution over the space of all text, is we can do this hash and then take a modulus of that hash. And so what that means is we have a uniform space that we project into. We take the modulus to reduce that space, but we still have a mapping that we believe is nearly unique for each word. Ideally, to be a perfect one-to-one mapping, then every word goes to an independent place in space. But because we want to preserve memory, we're willing to say, like, okay, maybe the and exquisitely fantastic, all as one word, clash in the same place. That's actually okay because the context in which they occur is pretty different. So we're trading off space for the occasional error. And the interesting thing about that is if we do that, we end up with something that's a unique mapping that doesn't have to look at the vocabulary. So if we know what hash we're using and what modulus we're using, we can run that on every computer independently without looking at all of the data set beforehand. Basically, we've given ourselves that dictionary of the English language. So that's actually really nice because then we don't have to go through the data set. We don't have to do a lot of things. We just take this mapping function, map into some space, and then we classify on the hashed version of the features. The only real downside of this is you have a hash and then you have a mapping, but you don't have an inverse mapping. So if you're very interested in like introspection of like what word is giving me this huge positive value, you don't really have a backwards mapping beyond stuffing words into the hashing vectorizer and seeing where they come out. Obviously, for all words, this is not going to be useful, but sometimes it can be useful enough. If you have a classification for a particular sentence, you can push it through the vectorizer, see what features become active, and then do something with that information. So it's not quite as direct as inspecting the features, but there's still tricks you can employ. So we have something in scikit-learn called the hashing vectorizer that does this for you. It's pretty much plug and play with Count Vectorizer and Dict Vectorizer and a lot of the other vectorizers we have. So the hash has a clash, right? So it's a fundamentally it's a many to one mapping. So it's not a function, so you can't have it's a many to one function, so you can't have the inverse directly. It could, but then you have to push all words through the vectorizer, and then you're back to where you started. So basically, that's kind of what you end up doing if you want to inspect it, is you like take the things you know, shove them through the vectorizer, and say, okay, these two words clash into this particular feature. And then you say, well, either one of these features could be active if this turns on. So you kind of have to do that manually, because otherwise you get right back to a dict vectorizer again. So we can do basically the same structure, build an analyzer, transform things, we fix the output size ahead of time. 2 to the 20 is default because it seems to work pretty well for most problems. You can turn that up or turn that down, and depending on the problem, that could be important. And we get a sparse matrix. We build a pipeline. We use another type of classifier called a passive-aggressive classifier that's pretty simple. And we get a decent performance on predicting the polarity of these tweets. I'm not 100% sure what the label balance is, so maybe we can look at that really fast. Oh, this is validation set. So it's not clear what the balance is between positive and negative tweets, but maybe we covered it up here. In any case, this could be actually really good, or it could be like maybe only okay if there's like a 60-40 split between positive and negative tweets. I think this data set's actually balanced, but you'd want to check for yourself. So then we can also check against the full data set, because this actually does fit in memory. So there, in the old experiment, there was a much, much larger notebook that actually parallelized over IPython parallel clients and a bunch of stuff. So if you're interested in kind of this big data text processing thing, maybe look at the 2013 session and kind of check out how they did this distributed computation. For us on the MacBook Air, not going to happen. So we can also look at the vocabulary here. But in return, we get a huge vocabulary, and it's also unpickable because it's a dictionary. And there's ways around that, but they're not pretty. So out of core learning, we now have this mapping that gives us fixed output space. We know that there's only positive and negative tweets in our little world, and now we can do incremental learning with partial fit. So partial fit is another method we haven't really talked about. Basically what it is you create an object, you partial fit it, and then you give it more data and partial fit it again, and it kind of remembers the stuff it's seen before. So this is different than the standard scikit-learn classifier, because the classic scikit-learn classifier, when you fit it again, it restarts, it reboots itself. So partial fit, if you're into this out-of-core incremental stuff, look for algorithms that support partial fit. Some do, some don't. It really depends. So here we can create something that's simulates an infinite Twitter stream. I won't go into much detail about that. Basically, it just gives you batches of stuff. And so this would kind of be like hitting Twitter's streaming API every 5 minutes or something. So we get some data. We look at the targets. We use the hashing vectorizer and the passive-aggressive classifier again. We loop over the batches, which basically simulates pulling data from that API. Every once in a while, we compute validation scores and print them out. And so we kind of have this classifier that's running in the background, continuously reading tweets or documents or whatever, and slowly learning what is a positive and what is a negative tweet. And because we're not worried about trying to build this vocabulary and do all these complicated things, this becomes much more straightforward. can now plot the validation scores here, and we see that we've kind of like capped off. It seems like more and more and more and more and more data may not help us too much at this point. At this point, we've kind of like partial fit our way to something that for the validation set seems to be predicting at a flat level. Whether it's underfitting or overfitting, you'd have to look at the training as well. But basically, it looks like reading more and more and more data is not really going to help us too much. We talked about collisions. If you have a lot of collisions, like if instead of 2 to the 20, you use 2 to the 2, you can imagine you're hashing every English word into 4 bins. That's a very bad idea. If your space is too large, it costs more memory. There's no inverse, so you also can't really do inverse document frequency reweighting because you haven't actually read any documents. So there's a number of problems, but basically what you gain is parallelization at the loss of some interpretability. So if you're into like lots of text processing, that's a good option for you. And so with that, I will basically conclude the session. There should be a feedback form for this, for these sessions, both the morning and the afternoon. Please fill that out and let us know how we've done and let us know what to improve. We have another hour. All right. Great. I thought it ended at 4. So we have another hour. What do we want to do? We can go back to Titanic, I guess.
Yeah, we can go back to Titanic and escape to exercises.
Okay, yeah.
Maybe go back to
Titanic. All right. So we've teased enough the categorical and numerical features. So I'll go back to something we had to skip in the morning due to time that basically combines categorical and numerical features to try to predict if you would die on the Titanic or not. So this is there's a bunch of really cool stuff if you're used – oh, there's a question. Ah, okay. So the question was – with the NLP example, why are we not looking at like stemming or kind of like normalization for the words? And basically, it's just due to time. We basically just want to show how to do the out-of-core stuff. The stemming and that kind of thing would go into the pre-processing stage. And NTLK is a good option for that, and you can basically push that as far as you want to go. If you think you're having lots of clashes because people are doing weird misspellings, or if you want to like normalize like capital and lowercase and these kinds of things, there's always options to do that kind of before you even do the hashing. So there was two more questions, one of which was, is there any reason we couldn't build a dictionary, go over the tweets data set and build a dictionary that kind of encodes all the words we expect and also like shortcuts like OMG and these kinds of like shorthand notations that show up on Twitter. And also there was another question on like on the emoticons data set, is there a way to look at the emoticons on Twitter and build a dictionary over that? So it is definitely possible to go over some subset of the documents, build a vocabulary, go over some set of the documents, build a vocabulary, or some set of documents, build a vocabulary, and then combine the vocabulary at some step. Fundamentally, that boils down to like a map and then a reduce step. And so the problem with parallelization is always in the reduce step. At some point, you have to have all of these end nodes communicate their results together, and you have to have a computer that can, for sure, at least take all of the results and ideally hold all of them in memory and then mash them together. If that's not the case, you have to have computers that can take pairs, mash them together, then take those pairs and mash them together, take those pairs and mash them together, and you get into a lot of like complicated communication processes. So this is only really a problem when you have like huge vocabularies and lots of documents. But it's the kind of thing that you directly avoid with a hashing vectorizer. You'd never have to do this because you know that the vocabulary is shared over all machines because it's a fixed mapping. And as far as the emoticon stuff goes, I'm not familiar with, I guess it would almost be like stemming for emoticons, like winky, happy face goes to just like smiley or something like that. I would say you can probably look around at the literature for tweet sentiment analysis because there's a lot of people studying it and it has a lot of different properties than standard text. Because people only have 140 characters and they're trying to communicate specific things, it's actually pretty noisy. There's lots of weird abbreviations and lots of strange kind of, not an inside joke, but like shared lingo that's not necessarily pure English. So I would say if you're interested in that stuff, just start Googling around and looking for papers on the subject. So if there are any other questions, oh, there's a question here. Yeah. So the comment was there's broken links on the hashing trick. So I'm going to check that out. One, if the links are broken, you can just Google like hashing trick and you'll see a number of results. There's a site called hunch.net that is run by the creator of Valpal Wabbit, and they actually have a really nice paper on how the hashing trick is used and how it can be used in like a wide variety of applications. But if you Google it and then find the links there, that's basically what I linked to. So for feature extraction, say we have categorical and numerical data mixed together and we want to deal with it. How do we do that? This will be a simple example. It also kind of follows some examples that are on the Kaggle tutorial site. So they go through this Titanic data set in Python, in R, and maybe even MATLAB at this point. They go through it in a number of different languages and kind of show you how to walk through a classification. And so we're kind of building on that, developed independently, but definitely if you're interested in trying to find different approaches for the same data set, that's a great place to look. So we talked about numerical features. If we go back and look at Iris, fundamentally, the numbers we get out are numerical. They encode length and width in centimeters for petals and sepals. Now, if we tried to encode the color and we had a set of colors, then that's what we call a categorical variable. So that means it's one of n variables. And this is basically what we're doing with text. When we build a bag of words, we're saying, we have this set of all possible words. Is this word in set? Word in set, turn on. Like cat in set, turn on. Dog in set, turn on. So with that, we kind of say we have these two separate things that we've covered independently. But there's lots of data sets where you can have both, right? Maybe you have a product review that has a numerical score, but then it has text along with it as some kind of sentiment of how good or bad they thought this was before they reviewed it. And you can actually use that information together to build a stronger classifier. So we'll kind of show one strategy how to do that. Like Andy said, there's some classifiers like random forests and decision trees that should be able to handle this like as a first class citizen. But scikit-learn right now is kind of treating everything as it's either a numerical feature or you do bag of words to turn it into a numerical feature. That's one of the things we're working on because it's kind of specific to trees. So we talked about dict vectorizer and count vectorizer. Here's the example again. We see we get kind of like a one hot thing, and then we still have temperature as a numerical feature over here. And because we use dict vectorizer, we actually have introspection of what each column means. Dubai, yes. London, yes. San Francisco, yes. Temperature. So derived features. We talked a lot about dimensionality reduction and stuff, PCA and manifold learning. So that's one way you can get numerical features is take some input features, do dimensionality reduction, get some reduced feature set that you think is important, and then use those numerical features to make a classification. So you could imagine if you had an image and the text associated with it, you would do a pre-processing for the text and a pre-processing for the image independently, group them back together, and then do something with that. So here we'll show an example of how to combine numerical and categorical features. You could do this a lot easier if you use pandas, but we chose not to get into pandas in this tutorial and not to include it as a dependency. There's a tutorial from 2014 at EuroSciPy that was all focused on pandas and scikit-learn. So if you're doing a lot of this kind of analysis, you should definitely check out that tutorial and those sets of slides as well. So the first thing we want to do is open up the Titanic dataset that was provided here. The only thing that we did is we converted from an Excel spreadsheet to CSV so we could manipulate it easier. Good news, if you decide to use pandas, it can work with Excel spreadsheets. So that's actually kind of crazy because lots of people will send you Excel spreadsheets and say, I need something done with this, go, and pandas will handle that for you. But in this case, we use CSV to make things easier on ourselves. And the data set's pretty small. So when we look at all the keys that are in the file, we see stuff like P class, did you survive, what was your name, what was your sex, what was your age, how many siblings and children did you have, what ticket did you purchase, how much did you pay, where were you in the cabin, did you get on a boat, did they find your body, what was your home and your destination. So they give a pretty good description of what these all mean here. Fundamentally, our label is survival. That's the thing we want to try to predict. We want to try to say, okay, given this group of people and some knowledge about where they're at, who survived? And it's important to note that we don't believe that this analysis should generalize to all boat crashes ever. All we really want to do is analyze for the Titanic, given a subset of people that we don't know about, what is our prediction of whether they lived or died? Because not all the bodies were found, right? We don't know who lived and who died. So there's actually some relevance to that. So in general, we have some subset of labels that are candidates to be categorical features that will basically treat kind of like dict vectorized, and the other part that seem to be numerical features. So stuff like passenger fare, for example, is a numerical value, and Passenger class kind of falls into a special category called ordinal data. We won't talk about that much, but there's an ordering in the relationship. It's like a set, but there's an ordering between them, and that requires some specific assumptions. So given all that, we can write a big nasty chunk of string processing in Python to handle each field of the data and line by line return the feature group for the string data and the floating point data. So you see we got the fare, how much it cost. We still have the string for the sex, whether they survived or not. The ticket number is a string, so it's going to be treated as a categorical. It probably doesn't mean anything. The same with the name. Those two are probably weak features for classification, but we have them in there anyways. So given that, we can use the string and numeric keys, go through the data, and build basically a chunk that is numeric data, the labels that go along with it, the string features, and the labels that go along with it, and then we concatenate them together. And the labels should be the same across everything, because we're kind of taking a chunk, getting the numerical part, getting the string part, and then we have labels that go with it. And then we process them separately, kind of concatenate the data together, and then do something with it. So that's what all of this code is kind of doing. And it's a little gnarly, but it's data in the real world. And this is kind of a clean example, engineered to be easier. So it kind of goes to show you that scikit-learn has done a lot of work on the API side and on the model side to try to make things as easy as possible. But to some extent, you have to get your hands dirty in the data and figure out what it means for your problem and, you know, mess around with it until you can get a 2D array to feed to scikit-learn. So now, given this, we can concatenate the train and test data, and now we have the categorical piece, the numerical piece together, and the label that goes with it. So we've kind of taken each person's entry and broken it into what we need for scikit-learn's API. Because random forests are great and always good at as a first-pass classifier, we just throw everything in. And here we say the random chance is 50%. Technically, that's true, but if you use a dummy classifier and just predict everyone lived or everyone died, I think that's more around 70%. So we're not doing much better than just predicting you always lived or you always died. So the exercise here is basically to go through, now that we have some data and we have a classifier, and try to do stuff like plotting the feature importance and see which features are useful and which ones aren't, or remove some features, fill in missing data. So there's a bunch of stuff in the data that has been filled in with minus ones or something. And in a lot of the examples for Kaggle, most of the work is in filling these in intelligently. Also, can you switch classifiers? Try to do some simple things and see if you can improve the score beyond barely above the average level. And also, if someone wants to plot the dummy classifier for this, that would also be useful. Like, if you do the dummy classifier most frequent, what's the score? So I guess we'll take like 5 or so minutes to do that, and then we can go back to some other exercises that Andy had. 10 minutes? Okay, 10 minutes. And if anybody needs help, just raise your hand and we'll come around. Okay, so it's been about 10 minutes. I'm going to try to walk through something that resembles a path to a solution by looking at the feature importances in this particular example. So I linked to a plot here that shows the feature importances for a random forest classifier. It's pretty straightforward. Once you've trained a random forest or an extra trees classifier, you can look at feature underscore importances underscore and do some stuff with that. So let's try to, build that out. Yes. Okay, so we have some feature importances. And yes, I do use the scikit-learn examples all the time because they're extremely useful. And that's not going to work because this needs to be CLF. So what we want to get out of this is what features are important and what features aren't. And this is really important for figuring out which features to drop from our particular solution. So in this case, the guess is that stuff like name and home desk actually isn't very informative, because we don't believe that name is actually shared over multiple people. There's not a lot to be gained by looking at someone's name beyond sex, really, maybe. Even that's actually pretty difficult to do. Yes. Okay, that's a fun one. So if we look here, we have feature number 4 as the most discriminative, and then feature 0, feature 1, and feature 3. So let's try to figure out what those features were. And also, we're just going to give up on the plotter because ain't nobody got time for that. Okay, so we have feature number 4, which should fall into the numeric data, because we concatenated the numeric to the train categorical. So we can actually look at the numeric keys, and we have 0, which is P class. Let's just actually copy this for a safe reference. We're not doing anything with that beyond looking at it for convenience. So we have P class here that is feature 0. That seems to be the second most important thing for making a classification. Feature number 4 is the most important. So if we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, parch is the most important. So what the heck is parch? And we're also only plotting the top 10. So this also means there's lots and lots and lots of features that aren't useful at all. So if we look at parch here, the number of parents and children aboard has a huge importance on who lived and who died. Now, why would that happen? Because people who either had parents on board if they were children, or children on board if they were parents, were the first people on the lifeboats. So this feature is like really, really, really important in predicting who made it onto a lifeboat, and presumably who had the best chance of survival. So going down the list, we see that feature 1 is also important, which is not survived, or shouldn't be, because if it is, we should be perfect. We make sure that didn't happen. Yeah, we stripped out survived here. So that means feature number 1, well, that actually reduces my count. Let's think about this. So this is also the fun of coding a live solution, or not coding, copying a live solution. So if we take this out, relook at the count. Well, 3's in here too, so my statement about this still stands. So the keys that are actually in there are P class, age, sibsp, parch, and fair. So this is telling us that 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Fair is very, very, very important, as is parch, as is age, as is the class. So what this means is that the fair you had indirectly tells you what floor of the boat you were on. So if you didn't have a lot of money and you bought like a cheap ticket, you would probably be on the bottom of the boat. And so if the lifeboats are on the top of the boat, when something happens, you can't get up the lifeboats in time, and ergo, your rate of survival goes down. So there's, once again, if you're really interested in this, there's the Kaggle analysis is actually really interesting. And they go into like feature engineering new features and figuring out like how to fill in data, like if someone's age isn't available, how can you fill it in a smart way based on their passenger class and things like this. And it gets more into like data manipulation and encoding your knowledge into how you augment the data. So if data is missing, but you're an expert in the type of data you're looking at, you can put your knowledge in there. You don't have to say something like, it's -1. Like, I don't have an age. Age is -1. Well, that's not true. If we know they had four children on board, they're probably older, whereas if there's 2, they might have been a child and their parents were the one on board. So that affects what you predict. You can put in the mean for a particular passenger class instead of just a -1. You could go all the way down the road with this. But fundamentally, what this feature ranking should tell you is which features to drop to get a better score. So let's just try something and see if it gets better. This says that basically all the numerical stuff is useful. Well, all the numerical stuff and the first categorical seems to be useful. And my guess is the first categorical is, that is surprising. I don't know if that's actually right. So this is the other problem of not using a combined thing that scikit-learn has built in, is you have to go back through your logic and figure out which feature maps to which thing. So for now, let's just try training on the numerical stuff only and see what happens. So that will be modify this line here. Did anybody run the dummy classifier on this to see what the dummy classifier predicts? All right. So we don't actually know. That would be another good experiment to try. So our accuracy goes down a little bit. So that means some of the stuff in the categorical information for this particular data set split is informative. So you can't throw out all of the strings. You have to do something with them as well. And yeah, so then sex would be one of the ones to try to put back in. So we would have to go up here, back to this, and what I would like to do some really yes, I like to use So I like to use these kinds of tricks, but it looks like it's not going to work. So anyways, we'll give this up for now because I could hack on this all day. Basically, this is kind of your exploratory phase of figuring out what features are useful and what aren't for a particular classifier. And you can mess them up, as I just did.
Also, this would be a lot easier probably using pandas.
Yes, absolutely.
But we didn't want to cover pandas. The question was, why do we have 1,000 features? The answer is because there are so many unique names, and names don't repeat. And so, it's not bag of words. It's each name is unique.
Yes.
Each unique name is a unique feature. It's a unique value of a categorical variable.
So if you treat the name as one word,
that's yeah. So that's really a stupid thing to do. Okay. Okay, I don't know. So I think in the remainder of the time, we could cover more material. I don't think that's really the best thing to do. So there's an exercise here in the pipelining, and also I think in the trees, if you want to go these or have questions about these. These are mostly grid searching and pipelining examples here for gradient boosting, playing with gradient boosting, and in the pipelining, just working with pipelining. So you can work on these if you like and ask a question. Otherwise, I'd just open it for like general FAQ if you have any question, or QA, I guess. If you have any questions, ask us now. We'll also stick around for a while. There's something, yeah. Wait, was it like a trick question or something? Because, okay, so actually I wanted to include this, but I kind of forgot about it. Yeah. Yes, that is my advice. So there's a thing that we actually want to include. It's in the scikit-learn documentation. If you go on documentation, there's a flowchart, which is a very silly thing, which tells you, depending on what kind of task you have, what kind of data, what is the first thing you should try. So if you don't, and then if you click on it, it'll give you some documentation. It tells you what is good for small data and for large data and for text data and so on. Obviously, this is like the first starting point. And other than that, I mean, there's a lot of discussion in Kaggle forums, for example, for that. But if you have a real world data set, ask your data scientists. I don't know. So there's general advice. I mean, the documentation also has advice. Like each of the classifiers has like this is cases when this model will probably work well. actually, I want to do more of that in documentation, but it's also hard to do very general statements. But this is like, this thing gives a very rough guideline. Okay, so the question is how many samples do you need for how many features? So my flowchart, which obviously is always right, says you need at least 50 samples or you need to call your statistician. So I said...
And that doesn't say how many features.
It doesn't say how many features. I mean, it depends a lot on the algorithm. I mean, you could do that with arbitrary many features, you need just need to regularize more. So if you do cross-validation, you need you can use arbitrary many features. And basically, regularization should be able to overcome the problem of having too many features. You need...
Is it true with all of the different algorithms, or do you recommend certain algorithms over others?
If you have very many features, I would probably start with like linear models, probably elastic net penalized.
What if it's not very many features, but it's more like not much data? Like 8 features, 80.
Do a grid search over all models with all parameters because it'll take like at most a day. I don't know. It depends a lot on if you can good performance out of a linear model. I trust that a lot more, and I would probably do like at least nested cross-validation, probably with 10-fold cross-validation or 20-fold cross-validation, or this random shuffle split with like 100 repetitions, so you have like very robust estimates. I think your biggest problem might be that your data set is too small, so that like 10-fold cross-validation will give you very bad estimates. And depending, if you have like a 10-class classification problem, and your test set is only 8 samples, it's not going to be very informative, right?
So you said do a nested?
Yeah, the nested cross-validation is this thing that I thought I had did here, but it's only in the paid-for version at O'Reilly. So nested cross-validation is the one where you do cross-validation, inside cross-validation you do a grid search. Yeah, but it's not in the one that you have because I just added, I added it before. I'll check it in, so it'll be online later, but basically what you do is you do grid search, which does the parameter estimation, and you do cross-val score around it. So this does like 2 levels of splitting of the data. And so this will give you a very robust estimate. And I should create a figure to explain this because I can't do it in words.
So is there a reason why we do grid search as opposed to some optimization technique?
Question is, why do we do grid search instead of some optimization technique? The answer is they're non-convex global optimization problems. And so you can do more fancy optimization, and usually people do Bayesian optimization. That's a, like, you need a global optimization strategy. If you do, I mean, yeah, you could do some Monte Carlo estimate. And most people now use Gaussian processes with expected improvement. We haven't done that yet. If you have a high dimensional thing, or if you have like 10 parameters, randomized search will not work well, and it will work well. The thing is, we have randomized search, which samples from uniform distributions instead of doing like a MCMC or Gaussian process thing. If you look at the plots of the papers that actually compare these, the randomized search is very close to like the state-of-the-art Bayesian optimization techniques. So it's kind of hard to make the Bayesian optimization work, and randomized search does nearly as well. So But you can do global optimization schemes. It's just, I mean, it's NP-hard to do it exactly, so it might work for you. Also, most of the models in scikit-learn only have like 2 or 3 parameters, and then you're good with grid search. Any other questions? There's Wart. Wart allows you to define a connectivity matrix, and that allows you to do spatial constraints. So the people in the some of the scikit-learn developers use this for like brain image cluster fMRI clustering, I think. And so you can put in connectivity constraints there.
So but,
yeah, I mean you can also like there's several methods that you, where you can put in an adjacency matrix. Like dbScan can do that. Okay, I'm not sure which. Spectral clustering also, I mean, it's a kernel matrix. But in Wart, you can put in hard constraints on the connectivity. Question was how to work with like dialogue type text where the order is important. The answer is I have no idea. You have no idea? Is it convolutional nets?
Well, it's less complicated.
Is it LSTMs are not less complicated than convolutional? Come to my talk on Wednesday. I'll tell you how to do it. Also his talk at the, no, that's before mine, right? Come to our talks on Wednesday. I mean, if you have a fixed length of question answers, you could encode bag of word for each of them. That's basically what Carl said. Like, this is the question, this is the answer, this is the question, this is the answer. If they're always length 2 or length 4, and then you have just a longer feature vector. And that could work. If you have arbitrary length, no, so the question is, how is feature importance for random forest computed? I don't have the formula in my head. It doesn't hold one out. It's you can accumulate all the Gini index improvements, so the improvement that a split does over all trees that for the splits that involve that feature. Yeah, well, Gini index or entropy or whatever your splitting criterion is. The decision tree has a splitting criterion that says what makes a split good. And so you can, so that says like how much does it decrease or how much does it make each side more pure. So after you do the split, you hope one class is more frequent in one side than the other side. And you, there's some measure in the tree that's defined in the tree that says how good is the split in this sense. And then you can accumulate all the improvements for a given feature. Like, each time this feature was selected to split on, how much did you improve? And then you accumulate it over all trees in your forest and over all splits in your tree, and then, but I don't know the exact formula, but it's based on this improvement per split.
Sort of related, with the decision tree, you know, you get some idea of how variables might
look at 100 trees.
So is there a way to visualize the tree?
I don't think people usually try to pick apart random forests. Also, people, I don't know, depends. Trees of depth greater than 10, you can also not really visualize anymore, I feel. But you could visualize all the trees in a forest, but you'd spend a lot of time on it. I think it's very hard to try to interpret what a random forest is. Most people treat it as a well-working black box. Most people that like do machine learning kind of things or call what they're doing machine learning don't care that much about interpretability, which is a problem because a lot of people work for like a business and they need to tell a manager what they're doing, and it's not really possible. We don't have that. I think there's a pull request for that one.
Because that's very general.
Any method, yeah. So there's a pull request for that one. There's an R feature selection method that does this based on trees. I forgot the name of it. And there's a pull request to do this in scikit-learn. It's very easy to implement, but we haven't done that yet. But that's not what feature importances does. That's not what feature importances does. Feature importances currently only looks at the improvements per split. Okay. Yeah, I think we'll break it up here. And if you have more questions, we are here. Ask us. I hope you learned something.